Man, you hear this bullshit they be talking? Every day, man, it's like these motherfuckers is just like professional liars, you know what I'm saying? Wow. Listen. Bin Laden didn't blow up projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga. Bin Laden didn't blow up projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
I pledge no allegiance, nigga. Fuck the president's speeches. I'm baptized by America and covered in leeches. The dirty water that bleaches your soul and your facial features, drowning you in propaganda that they spit through the speakers. And if you speak about the evil that the government does, the Patriot Act to track you to the type of your blood. They try to frame you and say you was trying to sell drugs and throw a federal indictment on niggas to show you love. This shit is run by fake Christians, fake politicians. Look at their mansions and look at the conditions you live in. All they talk about is terrorism on television. They tell you to listen, but they don't really tell you their mission. They funded Al-Qaeda and now they blame the Muslim religion. Even though Bin Laden was a CIA tactician, they gave him billions of dollars and they funded his purpose. Fahrenheit 9/11, that's just scratching the surface.
Bin Laden didn't blow up projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga. Bin Laden didn't blow up projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
They say the rebels in Iraq still fight for Saddam, but that's bullshit. I'll show you why it's totally wrong. Cause if another country invaded the hood tonight, it'd be warfare through Harlem and Washington Heights. I wouldn't be fighting for Bush or white America's dream. I'd be fighting for my people's survival and self-esteem. I wouldn't fight for racist churches from the south, my nigga. I'd be fighting to keep the occupation out, my nigga. You ever clock someone who talks shit or look at you wrong? Imagine if they shot at you and was raping your moms. And of course Saddam Hussein had chemical weapons. We sold them that shit after Ronald Reagan's election. Mercenary contractors fighting a new era. Corporate military banking off the war on terror. They controlling the ghetto with a failed attack. Trying to distract the fact that they engineering the crack. So I'm strapped like Lee Malvo holding a sniper rifle. These bullets will touch your kids. And I don't mean like Michael. Your body be sent to the morgue, stripped down and recycled. I fire on house niggas that support you and like you. Cause innocent people get murdered in the struggle daily. And poor people never get shit and struggle daily. This ain't no alien conspiracy theory. This shit is real. Written on a dollar underneath the Masonic seal.
Now I don't rap to dead presidents. I'd rather see the president dead. It's never been said, but I set precedents.
Bin Laden blow up the projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga.
Bush knocked down the tower.
Tell the truth, nigga. Bin Laden blow up the projects. It was your nigga. Tell the truth,
City
nigga.
City Records was 80 seconds away from the tower. Some cowards fought with the wrong building. They meant to hit ours.
Close the door.
Y'all don't wanna hear me, you just wanna dance.
Hang on, Sean.
Hey, Mike, you there? Mike, you there? Hello. What's going on here? Why can't I hear myself? Mike, hello? Where's my fucking... Oh, there it is. Hey, Mike, you there? Hello. Hello.
This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill.
All that noise.
Stay in Wonderland.
I thought I had that fixed.
And
I really did.
How deep the rabbit hole goes.
Hey, now. You'd think I have this stuff working properly by now, honey, wouldn't you? No, you wouldn't?
No.
It's all choppy and not working right. Guys, welcome to First 52, RazRadioLive.com. Salty Talk TV, Twitch TV, or Salty Talk Radio, Switch TV. My intros, there's something wrong with my intro over there, so.
You could kick it off.
It sounds horrible. Anyway,
welcome
to the First 52, guys. Glad you're here with us tonight. I have a very busy night tonight. We got a lot of people to talk to. We got Mike Wathers, formerly of the Bubba Love Sponge Show, joining us. We have Scott Ledger, formerly of the BRN, talking about what he's got going on in the future. He's going to join us in the second hour. About 8:30, he'll be jumping on board. I want to welcome all the new listeners, new viewers. This is my world here. This is how we do it. Welcome to my studio. Let's put it that way. I don't want to keep Mike waiting too long on hold there. He is already here with us, so I'm going to bring him up right away. Mike, how you doing over there?
What's going, Sean? What's up, Sean?
How you doing, man?
Good to be here, man.
I'm glad to have you. You know, we've met multiple times. I've come out to some of the Cluster F meet and greets, and we've hung out all different kinds of times. And you're a really good guy. I've always enjoyed hanging out with you. I don't know if you remember my wife. Honey, say hi to Mike.
Hi, Mike.
Hello. How's it going? Yeah, I remember. Great. I remember you guys for sure. I mean, you've been a part of the BRN for years. I mean, you know, even back at the old studios where we used to do the I.O. shows.
The good old days.
The good old days.
You know what's funny about that, Mike, is I've got two pieces of soundproofing in my studio here that are from the BRN, from the Lemon Street studio. And this microphone arm that I have, the boom arm that I have, is from Lemon Street also. So that shows you how much into the BRN I was.
Just pick
he,
it clean.
He robbed the place.
I didn't rob it, but I know people that did.
Like a buzzard, just picking off the bones.
Right? No kidding.
Well, Lemon Street was, that studio wasn't that big, but, I mean, we did some fantastic radio in that studio.
Oh, it was an incredible place to be. I've only been in the new studio once, and I actually liked Lemon Street better, in my personal opinion. I know it was small, but...
I mean, it was intimate. I mean, it wasn't that, it was good enough for what we did, My, yeah, as usual, my vote was, hey, why don't we just stay here? And that didn't work out.
Yeah, well, you know, that's how it goes.
Overridden as always.
Yeah, right, right. So, like I said, I don't really want to get into too much of that, but I do, one of the questions I've always had for you, and I really was curious about, and I'm sure you've answered this millions of times, but how did you get into parody work?
Pretty much a fluke. I mean, I was always like, yeah, I never could find my way, just doing odd jobs and, you know, driving a truck and substitute teaching and, you know, working at a beverage drive-thru. And I was always in my spare time, I was making stupid videos with my brother, you know, just because that's what I like to do. And then it was like, what year was that? 1988, 89, when the Power Pig came on. I used to always listen to 970 WFLA. I was a big talk radio fan. And the 93 came on, and there was a sister. There were sister stations with WFLA. So Mark Chase is on there with Bob Lasseter, and there these two. I'm like, these two guys. You know, I love Lasseter, and this guy is amazing. You know, this Mark Chase guy. So I immediately made a fake resume. You know, it was nothing but jokes and bullshit, and I sent it to him. And he called back, and he's like, "Hey man, why don't you come down to the station and hang out?" And I was like, "Holy shit." You know, I've had zero experience, so I went down there. He's like, man, I'll pay you $100 a week. You know, you just hang out and learn stuff and write me some of that stuff you write, like, in the resume. And I was like, all right. And next thing I knew, I was on the morning show, and then I was on the MJ show, and then I said, fuck MJ, and I went to Iowa, did my own morning show, and then Bubba scooped me up, and it's the rest is history.
That's neat, the way that works out. I don't know if you knew this or not, but...
Total fluke.
It is. You know, some things just kind of happen.
Yeah,
You know, like, I grew up in the radio business. My father was a DJ in Philadelphia for 35 years almost. He was an oldies DJ. He spun the, you know, the oldies, the 50s, 60s, 70s. You know, that was his big thing. And I mean, when I was born, my parents used to take me to the studio and slide me my bassinet underneath the turntables at the studio and at the nightclubs that they would work at. So.
I did the same thing with my kids.
I could imagine. You know, it's weird that's how it goes down.
Yep.
And I never expected to do any kind of radio. I mean, I don't get paid for this. And maybe now I got my Twitch. I'm up to an affiliate on Twitch now, or affiliate. What's first? Affiliate's first, I think. So maybe I can make a little bit of money from doing this. But I've been doing this 8 years now, my own little thing. And I do it for stress relief. You know, I do it to get out of the real world and try to share what my thoughts and what's bothering me recently.
That's exactly.
That's what it's for. You know, that's the whole point of it.
I mean, that's like Sunday night, you know, it's very hectic what I'm going through and what I'm trying to do. And I was like, should I go do Jesus? So I was like, I have nothing. I was like, oh, but that's going to be an hour where I'm not thinking about shit. So I'm going to go ahead and do it, you know?
Right, right.
It's definitely a release.
How is it, man? I mean, 23 years, 19 years you were with Bubba over there.
23, actually.
23 years. And now you're it's completely different. You're not doing mornings anymore. You're, you know, you're not making that same thing every single day. How are you adjusting, man? Is it hard?
It's real hard. I was not planning on going from working on Bubba's show to doing 9 different, you know, streaming shows in a week, you know, and then trying to come up with, you know, content for all these shows and being the host of most of them.
Which we know you don't do very well.
Oh, yeah. I'm not a good host.
But you are. You've been doing well. I mean, I've been watching, and I'm excited to see. I like when anybody does anything, you know, like when you're moving forward and you're trying, that's what means the most. You know, I had knee surgery in February. I blew out my meniscus on my left knee. So yeah. I was out of work, sir.
I said, me too.
Yeah, it's horrible, man. It's so painful. Yeah. So I was out of work for 8 weeks and I was laying around and I went back to work and my boss was kind of a dick. And I'm sure you know what that's like. And I went back to work, no. And I just couldn't deal with it anymore. I'm like, no, I'm done with this. I can't do it. And I quit. And I started my own business in April. And it's been, I've been making twice what I was making. It was scary, but it worked out well for me. So I wish you the best on this
one. We're in similar situations. I have no plan. I was just one day, it was just like, nope. Nope. And once Donna can tell you, once I flip to one side, you know, it's done. Once I finally snap, it's like, no, never, ever, 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 ever again. No.
Right.
You know, why didn't I do this, you know, 5 years ago? But I'm very happy. I'm excited. You know, I'm making a lot of contacts. I got a lot of good people helping me. And what a tragedy it would have been if I'd never done this, maybe.
Yeah, that's what I say, too. You know, because my wife, thank gosh, she backs me up so much. And, you know, you got Donna behind you, I'm sure, backing you up 100%.
Oh, absolutely.
And without those women, we couldn't do any of this. I don't care what anybody says.
No, I would be a mess right now because she's the logistics queen. You know, I'm just the babbling head, and she's got to rein me in and help me with all this shit, you know, and deal with my, you know, stupidness. But she's amazing. And together, I told her, I said, together, we're the perfect combination.
Yep.
You know, we fit like that. And, you know, the things that I'm not good at, she can pick me right up with that stuff because she's good at everything.
Yeah, that's kind of like my wife, too. That's the way we work. You know what I like about Donna? We were at the Mockley Casino, the last show. What was that? 3-4 years ago, I believe.
That long ago.
A while ago.
Yeah, I think it was about three years ago now. That last.
Those were fun.
Yeah, well, that was the first one I had ever been to in that format. I went to the Venice one. Remember the hotel one at the Venice?
Yeah, that was pretty weak.
That wasn't.
I mean, I think we put on a good show, but that's, you know.
It was small.
You got an 8-foot ceiling. That's no place to have an event like that. You know, the crowd can't get into it. You know, you get a good venue and the crowd goes nuts. That venue was just kind of weird.
Yeah, what was the one we went to? There was, you guys did a Ned show, and it was in Ybor.
That was in Ybor, yeah.
Oh, the Ritz. So the Ritz show. Did you go to that one?
That was very fun. Yeah,
we were in the front row.
Most people don't remember it, and neither do I.
Half the people we were with don't either. Half of them were drunk or in fights. And
I mean, for some reason, people felt the need to just get obliterated that night, and that was fine with me because I had a fucking blast. And that's an example of, I mean, I had 700 people come see me, and I was like, okay, I did that, and I stopped.
Yeah.
And I should have said, fucking A.
Let's keep going.
I can fucking make a living doing this.
Yeah, exactly.
That was so fun, that one.
That was a really good one, yeah.
Never too late.
You were up there as Ned, and I don't know if you remember Poe. Alan Poe, he used to be around a lot back in the day. Humongous black guy. All right, he's from the Miami area. And he was there, and he had me up on his shoulders. And like I said, we were in the front row.
I do remember that. I definitely remember the dude on the other dude's shoulder. I was like, yeah. I was like, this is a Ned show.
That was me, yep. That was a really good show. That was the first big thing that Lexi and I went to with all of the Bub Army. And that was back, you know, one of the things that I've noticed, Manson, and I let me ask you this question. Ever since the introduction of Twitch into the show, the Bubba Army is not what it was, in my opinion. And I'm not putting anybody down, but it seems like, and this isn't about you guys, this is about us, the listeners. They've become angry. The Bubba Army isn't helping each other like they used to. Isn't happy to be around each other. They just want to be angry at each other all the time.
I mean, I think you make a brilliant point, Sean. What I think it did was it split the Bubba Army into a small segment of Twitch viewers who seemed to control everything. And the Bubba Army was almost cast aside when they were the bedrock of what we did.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't necessarily agree with that, but
I mean, Twitch is great. It's a great tool.
It is great. But you got it. Yeah, you just have to use it right.
Right. You can't ostracize the people that have been there for 15, 20 years prior to this additional tool being added to your weaponry.
Yeah. Plus, I mean, you know, but well, yeah, we. I mean, the growth was slow. But it was, you know, it was incremental growth, and then we plateaued, and we're less not getting into that stuff, but I could tell you when we plateaued and why we plateaued and why they're still plateauing, but hey, nobody ever wanted to hear one thing I ever said.
Right. Yeah. Well, and it sucks when your opinion or your voice is being missed. It really is. Now, moving forward, Mike.
Moving forward.
What is the plan? Like, are you, is it going to be the Wathers Radio Network? Are you guys going to, because obviously, you know, Trace, I love Trace. I think he's got some great talent deep inside of him that have corralled and pushed deep, right.
No. No, Trace has been doing some really good things. Actually, we may be filming the Dick Punch video tonight. We're very excited about that. I mean, you know, that's my dream, you know, to get the studio when it's done and have, you know, I do a show, Trace do a show, and then After Dark, you know, and various other shows. Who knows if that'll be something I can make a living at. I certainly can make some money at it.
Right.
I mean, I may be doing stuff, you know, digitally all over the country. I don't know what, you know, I'm trying everywhere.
And some voiceover work and things like that.
Yeah, we'll see who's, you know, right. Or what. It's going to be the most lucrative.
You know, I hear there's a station in Orlando that's just coming out. It's a talker station. I might know somebody that might be working over there, might be on later on today.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, okay.
So cryptic.
Well, you have to kind of keep things cryptic right now. I'm sure. I have a feeling it's probably the same place that Burke is looking at, and it's probably the same place that's teetering between Bubba and beer, hot wings and beer.
You're so cryptic.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
What? No clue.
Just throw it right out there.
Donna says she wants to know what you like about Donna, because I must have interrupted you and you never finished the story.
Oh, yeah. She's welcome to join in, too, if she wants to.
No, she's doing a million things.
Well, when we were at the Immokalee show, that's where I starburst. I'm really bad with starbursting. I tangent out and, like, I'm really bad with that. So we were at the Immokalee show, the last one, 3 years ago. And we got there early, but we didn't buy the VIP. Usually, back in the day, Chaz would VIP me on my own. I didn't have to pay for it. But at that point in time, Chaz wasn't around anymore. Pantera, well, I was actually buying some wax off of Pantera that day. Maybe. So anyway, Lexi and I went to eat.
The one time you don't say allegedly.
I know, right?
Yeah, the one time. So...
See what I'm saying? She keeps me in line, or she tries to. I'm hard to keep in line.
You're
so
big into candles. Big into candles.
I love my candles, man. You have to have good wax
good
in your
wax.
Candles.
Good wax, top grade.
So, we went to eat, and we're sitting there, and I see little Donna scurrying through, and she goes up, and she was trying to get some food right before the show. It was probably about an hour before showtime, and she's up at the bar, and she turns around, and she sees Lexi and I. She goes, "Oh, Raz, how you doing? What's going on?" You know, she came over and said hi to us and then went about her business. And she was busy. You could tell she was stressed out. There was something going on. I don't know if they didn't give you guys the food that they were supposed to or what happened. Something obviously happened, though.
Well, but right before Bubba Palooza, everybody's always stressed out because we're always running late. So, yeah, she was probably running to get something at the last second.
Yeah. But that's the thing. She took the second to recognize us, say hi. You know, even when we were down in Venice for the Jobber Miller.
She's good. She's good like that.
Yeah, well, I don't think she was there for the Jobber Miller thing, but even you know, you came over, you saw me. I'm not that guy that's going to run up to you guys and try to get your attention. You know, you walked past me, you're going to the bathroom to change after the ride.
So full of shit.
I'm not full of shit. And and you came over and you're like, "Raz, thanks, man. I appreciate that you're here." And then you went and did your shit, you know? And that's the one thing I liked about you guys. You know, you always did that.
I mean, you know, without the listeners, you know, what am I? I'm nothing. You know, I'm just a guy, you know, singing songs to nobody. So I always appreciate anybody who goes the extra mile and comes out to see me, or like, you know, Greg Havens. I saw he was promoting my show, you know, on various websites and, you know, stuff. I was like, you don't have to do that. I mean, that, you know, that really helps me out. And so I really appreciate anybody who goes the extra mile, because you certainly don't have to do any of that stuff. So I appreciate all that stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, let me tell you, I have Twitch Prime, and my Twitch Prime goes to Bubba. I've never paid for a subscription for something, and I paid for Cluster F subscription this past month because that's what I do. I support people I care for.
Well, I appreciate that, Sean. That means a lot to me. It's like... you know, unfortunately right now it's kind of a David and Goliath situation, because I've got, you know, I don't even have a studio to broadcast from, but I believe that if I just keep putting good shit out there every day, good shit, good shit, good shit. I've only been doing it 2 weeks, and I feel that like we're growing already. Good shit, good shit. People will recognize it.
I think so, too. It's weird with Twitch. Like tonight, obviously, I've got you on, so I'm way above what I normally would be doing. Having somebody like you on board, and then Scott Ledger later, because Scott's going to be joining me later on. He's going to talk about, I guess he signed his deal with his terrestrial deal today.
And oh, sweet. Well, congratulations to Scott. And if ever he has a chance to, I need to talk to him on, you know, on Facebook, reach out. I love the, you know, I never, me and Scott, we'd see each other fucking every Monday. Because he'd be doing Dangerous Conversation.
Right.
And we come in and do clusterfuck, you know, like, you know, hey, Ledge, you know, every hang out with Ledge for a little bit. Going to do the show one day, Ledge, going to do the show. Yeah, fucking, hey, fucking, we never fucking did it.
Right. It would be a good time to hear you guys together.
But I'd love to do it, you know. It's like, I'm not, you know, because I was, back in the day, I was just kind of lazy. I was fat and happy, you know, and I was like, yeah, I'll get
making the big dollars.
And I never got around to stuff because it was just like, yeah, you know, I was having just the time of my life.
Right.
Well, I'm still having the time of my life, but it's like, I need to make time for, you know, it's like, why didn't I make time for Sean Raz years ago? Because he's, you know, he's been a big fan. So I'm going to start trying to do that more.
Well, I appreciate that. And like I've said, Mike, I know you've got people around you that probably know a lot about the radio business and things like that. But when it comes to the studio, I've been doing this 8 years now, and we took a long time perfecting how to cheaply put together a good sounding studio. So if there's ever anything I can help you out with technology wise or wiring wise, I'm an old school. I like doing, you know, hardwired. I don't use USBs because if a USB goes bad, you can't just pull a wire and figure out which one it is. You actually,
Alexia, would it be all right if Sean came over tonight about midnight and stayed for 3 days?
But anything I can help you. Seriously, I would drive up there on a weekend or something, help you wiring up and things like that. That's the business I started up, Mike, was a handyman business. I was a maintenance technician for...
You may get a call one day.
Well, I gave you my number. You have my cell phone number. So please, if you need something, we're only 2.5 hours south of you. So I would definitely come up there and help you out finalizing some things.
Yeah, I appreciate it because, you know, like I said, I've been babied all my career. You know, everybody would just, you'd set everything up for me and I would just go in and do my stuff. And then I'd say, it doesn't work. And they'd come in and fix it. And then I'd say,
Do I sit here and talk to that?
That's it. I was babied. So, I'm learning some stuff. I'm learning, you know, I can stream myself now that it's all set up, and if it doesn't work, I can kind of figure it out sometimes, so I'm learning.
Scott said on the Twitch chat here, Scott said that he would love to have some radio with you. So,
all right, well, that's a done deal. I mean, like I said, I just need to start doing it. Like, there was some guys who messaged Ned, and was like, we want you to be on the Non Sequitur show. I don't know if you ever heard that. It's, you know, some YouTube podcast.
Right.
And, you know, I was like, well, they're fans. I was like, I'll do the show. So I dressed up as Ned and I did it. We had a good time. It's like, so I'm going to start doing more, you know, more of that stuff because, you know, I enjoy it. And, you know, if you're my fan and you want me to be on the show, I should do it.
Well, and it helps you get the name out and the word out of what's going on. You know, it's Cluster F Radio on Twitch, right?
Twitch.tv/ClusterFShow. And the Facebook is Cluster F Show.
Everything's going to be show then. Okay, good, good. We'll keep that in mind as we move. What's the, have you got a website guy going yet, or what's going on
website,
with that?
Website, waiting on a couple loose ends, and hopefully that'll be up next week, like the studio and the website very shortly, and then we'll really get rolling. And it looked like, I've been professionally broadcasting for 30 years. And I hate not looking professional, but that will end.
Honey, tell Mike when we just bought a house in December, right? That's how I tore my meniscus was moving into the new house. We bought a house, and what was the first thing I did?
The studio.
What is my studio like? I don't, Mike, have you ever seen pictures of my studio?
He got a whole separate room just for him to do this. For his hobby.
In our 3-bedroom house, one of the bedrooms is my studio.
Yeah. Well, that's what I got right here.
I wanted a guest room, and he was like, I don't like guests.
But just think of how much use you've gotten out of that room. I mean, endless hours of entertainment that you wouldn't have had.
Well, and it doubles as a great office because there's a big desk. You know, I have one, two.
You don't have to sell it to Mike.
I have four computers. This one room has four computers in it. I've got 12 monitors staring at me. I've got TVs on the wall. I've got beer cans everywhere. You know, it's
and in the closet is a washer and dryer. Unbelievable.
Too funny.
Oh man, I love this studio. I mean, when I did that whole year as Ned afternoons on a 98.7.
Right.
I'd go to work and then I would live in here till midnight and do that, you know, like four days a week. Then be on the couch at midnight and then hear the phone ring in here and have to jump the cat gate and try to get the phone before it quit ringing.
Honey, I don't know if you know, they live on, what do you got, like 30 acres, 40 acres, 20 acres? I know it's a lot of acreage,
yeah,
5 acres.
20. Like 20 acres.
Okay, 20 acres. They got horses. They've got multiple dogs, cats everywhere. So they kind of live that free range life, kind of.
It's nice.
Cool. Very nice.
Nice.
Yeah, that's our, not our dream, but we would like to live in that kind of way. But our end game is going to be, we're going to keep this little house we bought, and we want to buy a houseboat down in the Keys. And then do
it's
a like
totally
a back and forth
from what
thing.
They're doing, but
I know. Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
that's just
that's
our thing.
I mean, but that's cool too.
That sounds like a good deal to me.
Yeah, I know, right? Well, you don't like the water, though. I thought.
I'd like to be by the water.
You just don't like to be on it.
With a drink on my hand, I don't really like to go out on the boat too much. I'll go out on like Trace's boat.
The pontoon. I was just about to say, nice. I would love to have you guys down here one time because I have a 20-foot pontoon. That's what we do. I live. You know where Kevin Hazlett fishes?
Yeah, yeah.
Boca Grande. I live right off of Boca Grande. So we're literally 2 minutes from the intercoastal, 5 minutes from the beach. I love where I live. It's the best thing in the world.
That's pretty nice. Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, it's like I hope I can make this transition and make, you know, what I was making because, like, I don't want, you know, I built an addition to my house when I was balling it serious. And now it's like, well, I guess I'm going to have to sell it. It's like, I don't want to sell it because I want to keep this property. I like having the property. I like seeing the deer go through. I don't want somebody to buy it and put five houses on it and ruin it.
Right.
But we're going to see what happens.
I'm sure you guys will be able to pull it off. I mean, you're a lot of talent, man. I mean, you're not just Mike Wathers. You're a whole ball of different people, different things. I don't see any reason that you can't do either your own thing or your own thing in a mixture.
I mean, you know, I'm a pretty humble guy. I mean, I got a big ego, obviously. I'm in radio, you know, but
right.
I've always tried to be fairly humble and I always try to be decent to people. But, you know, now, you know, when I talk to people, I'm like, hey, you want to be number one, then hire me. Want me to take, you know, I can take, who you got working for you? I'll take them to number one.
Right.
So that's my attitude now. It's like, you know,
that's the attitude you should have because you can.
That's what I do.
Right. Exactly. I agree with you. I don't think there's anything off on that. I think we got through the basic things I wanted to touch on life. One of the things that got me interested in you when I started listening to Bubba, one of the first shows I listened to was After Sirius. It was you guys had it was on 102.5 and you had Jesse Ventura on. And I was big Alex Jones fan at the time and a big Jesse Ventura fan.
Yeah.
Which is what drew me in. And then you were the really, between you and Brent, kind of, but mainly you were the conspiracy guy. Or you let an impression that you questioned what was going on in the world more than anybody else in the room. And I know, you know, like Bubba would jump on the 9/11 thing every once in a while and say, oh, yeah, there's questions there. And then I would hear that in the shows going all the way back to then. But I think you truthfully, honestly believe that there's questions in the government and questions in what's going on in the world. Why? Well, I guess you kind of present that through Ned, but why are you going to continue to move forward and present those kind of things?
Probably. I probably now, you know, once, you know, I don't want to sit here, you know, at a card table in front of a Blue Yeti microphone in a Roger Tech webcam and do my I'm Right, You're Wrong deal. I want to do it in a studio maybe where I can take calls and, you know, be more comfortable. And but, you know, Sean, I mean, you know, I'm, you know how I am and you know how Donna is. She's worse than me about conspiracies. I almost feel like, is there going to come a time where I just quit saying this shit because that probably ain't doing my career any good. You know, nobody in power wants me to hear me talking about how it's all about the people in power fucking them. You right. know, maybe I just need to quit doing it. It's sad, you know. Do I be a poverty-stricken truth and justice warrior, or do I just toe the company line and make some money?
And that's what sucks. That's really the hard thing.
It really sucks, and they're making it really hard for people like me to get a job because you can't say shit anymore.
Yeah, what is up with that? How have we ended up here? How do we go from, you know, being able to say the average and point out things in weird ways? I think, was it you talking about how South Park, yeah, it was you and Trace, I think it might have been Kush Cab today. You were talking about how South Park went through and they did the whole racial, every single bad racial word
yeah.
that you could use. Was that today?
Yeah, it was today.
All right, I thought so.
I think so. Actually, I have no idea. It was today or yesterday.
It was one of the two. It was sometime this week.
Yeah. And they get they're like grandfathered in.
Yeah, how do you get? Yeah, well, but see, I think that's part of what has happened. God, here we go. I'm gonna get in that track again. But I think that's kind of what happened to Bubba, is he did and said so many dumb things throughout the years that now he's afraid to try to push the envelope, and he's being cowtailed to Twitch to everything, the way they're trying to deplatform everybody. He's all worried about making the dollar instead of pushing the envelope.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in my opinion, you just cultivate people with good content. That's all you do, is you put out good content. I believe a Friday night show, like if Bubba did a Friday night show back in the day with like Ned and Manson and Tuttle, and we were serious off the chain, you know, and we were smoking and drinking, fucking people, it would have been the best show and got the most ratings of any show, and the show really would have grown. But they chose a different route,
right?
You know, let's get some money.
Hey, that's true. I guess so. We all want money, but we got to do it as we do the right thing, as we continue to push content and give good content.
That's all I'm doing. I certainly don't want to ask people to give me money for bad content, so I'm trying to put out good shit.
What is the most annoying thing to you, Manson?
Annoying about what?
Annoying. What annoys you the most?
I'm telling you right now, it is the attack on the freedom of speech. That, you know, it's obvious to me. It's so obvious that the media and the government are working in concert, because neither party could care less about free speech. You know, the fact that you can't say this and you can't say that, and they're telling you what pronouns you can say, and that this person's getting offended. It's not a constitutional right to not be fucking offended. Suck my dick. It's the most ridiculous thing in the world. That really fucking annoys me. It's driving me insane, actually.
I think that's the worst thing right now in anything. I think you just nailed it right on, or hit the nail right on the head. I think
it defies common sense, because everything is about context.
Mm-hmm.
Everything. And if you say that something that's contextually not racial or homophobic, then it's not. And you can't pretend that it is just because you don't like the words I used, because you're a snowflake.
But isn't it really the left, white, rich person that's pushing this agenda or pushing this idea?
I think it's... Do you see the Republicans, you know, up in arms about the attack on free speech? Not really.
Yeah,
the
true.
Government doesn't want you to have free speech. It doesn't matter what party it is.
Yeah, that is true. I agree with that. You're right. You're right.
That's the last thing they want. So now, you know, I think people like me and you are a little more aware of it, because we have to watch what we say because we're talking in a public forum. But most people, you know, it hasn't reached them quite as bad yet.
Because they don't understand that it's there, and
but it's right. Oh, it's coming, because every day you see it. Every day you can't say this, and then the pronouns are this, and you can't say he, you can't say she. So it's pretty frightening.
You know what? Yeah, the he she thing. I can't
to recognize all 63 different genders.
You got this. You got this one transgender that I guess is putting a lawsuit out or fighting because they wouldn't give her a bikini wax, and she's like the most, or he is like, or whatever it is. That's the other thing. You know, like, don't force me to call you something I don't believe you are. know, if I want to call you a he and you think you're a she, I'm sorry, you're a he.
Yeah, that, Dave Chappelle's got a good bit about that. He's like, I don't care what you do, but don't be trying to force me to change my pronouns, man.
Listen, I worked in a salon back in the day, and if some chick came in for a bikini wax and I came in there and there was like a big dick in my face, I'd be like, you gotta go. Like, that's not happening.
Well, she's a trans, so.
I mean, I can only imagine.
That's what happened, though. Oh, well. They were like, we're not doing this.
Your dick is not... Why are you so hateful?
Why didn't you get the dick tongs out?
I don't know. I feel like you should at least warn somebody, like, but I have a dick.
Like, that seemed like that would be the courteous thing to do, it be at least
I feel
tell
like
someone.
It would, but
they,
you know.
They feel like they're not obligated to even tell you.
Honey, Bob Ripper Bong Ripper Bob likes your jugs, just so you know.
Oh, thanks.
Manson's giggling. Mike, it's okay, don't worry. She's got nice boobs. I mean, I'll be honest.
Oh, God.
I know, honey. Sorry. So, all right. So, we got that going on. We got Clusterfuck Show on Twitch.
Twitch.tv/ClusterFShow. Facebook ClusterF Show. Probably should promote my YouTube. I believe that's Cluster F Show as well.
That would make the most sense. More than likely, it would be Cluster F Show also.
Otherwise, I wouldn't know any of this shit.
Hey, aren't you... I know, right? You couldn't remember four different channel names. You'd be done. That would be the end of it for
not
you.
Not close, no.
Isn't there a meet and greet coming up with you guys again soon?
Like I said, we're just as soon as we get a free moment, we're just going to stop by someplace and say, hey, we're here if you want to have a drink with us.
I need a little more notice than that.
No, but we're not. You know, that's when we'll do the real meet and greet. Will be, you know, in a few months, and we'll give people, you know, like a 2 month window. Okay. But right now, it's like I told Donna, it's like if we're out somewhere and we're drinking, well, we should just tell people if you want to say hi, come say hi.
Yeah, I mean, if we're up in the area and you do that, we will definitely be there. Again, we're two hours south of you.
I mean, we'll be doing probably one, I would say, in 2 to 3 months.
Okay.
We got to get our shit together. Our shit is not together at all.
And you really need to look into what we did. And it was an amazing event that we did. We did three of them. And we called them Razzfest. You were laughing about this on the show a couple weeks
Those
ago.
Those were so debaucherous.
I remember you said that.
We would Razzfest. Yeah. Our last.
I can't even do another one because it was so.
The last one was bad. We actually rented a house. It was an old hostel or old like small hotel on Clearwater Beach. Last one we did. So we had this compound with like 15 rooms, a professional kitchen, a full like 20-person U-shaped bar with all the coolers, all the kegerators, all the ice machines, everything you needed. So we did 3 days. Had a pool.
It was too long, and we almost died.
Oh, my
like,
God.
Alcohol poisoning.
It was bad.
Was that a pretty penny?
No, it wasn't too bad. I think we paid... We had 20 or 25 paid guests. And I think we paid $100 a piece.
No, that's not bad.
It was more
than
that.
Was it more than that?
Yeah.
It might have been more than that. I don't know. Who knows?
It was a little more than that, but
I mean,
it was a good time, but we were all paid.
A 190, I think it was.
Yeah. Listening to you two reminds me a lot of myself and Donna, where I spout all this bullshit, and then she comes in and with all the facts.
Not really.
That's not what happened at all. You're lying again, Sean. But we did three of them. They were a blast, and like the first one was us meeting everybody that was part of Raz, and then the second one. We went to a resort on Inglewood Beach here. We filled up how many rooms?
It was like two floors.
We filled up two floors of this Damn. Resort. There was about 45, 50 people. We had people coming and going.
We're banned for life.
We got banned from the resort. If that tells you anything.
Yeah, we'd like to do something. I mean, you know,
it's Blind Lawrence's fault.
It was Blind Lawrence's fault.
Oh, jeez, poor Blind Lawrence.
Well, you know, Blind Lawrence has been on my station since the whole piss incident.
He's come on the air, you mean?
No, he does a show every Friday night.
Oh, I had no idea.
Yeah, he does a show every single Friday night.
Really?
On Raz Radio Live and on the show with No Name Network, I think, is the other network he's on.
I may steal him away from you, Sean.
He runs his own. Well, we'll share. We can share. That's okay.
I'm gonna make it rain on Blind Lauren.
As long as it's water and not piss, I'm sure he'll be all right with it.
I promise, no piss, Blind Lauren. Zero piss. Maybe some buttercup piss. That's it.
I've begged him so many times to try to reconcile, you know, back in the past, reconcile that situation. He just won't. He won't. But anyway, he does a show. The second Razzfest, the one we got banned from that hotel or from that resort, it took me 5 minutes with my, because I have a decent board, you know, a little Yamaha 12 channel, you know, slider board, on off switches. It's a decent board. So I had sat there with him and I showed him for about 5 minutes where all the buttons were. He ran his show all by himself, running the board, you know, pots up and down, switches on and off, all by himself. And it was incredible to watch. And that's what he does. He still runs his own board on his show on my station.
Oh, that's pretty cool. I'll have to check it out.
Well,
Friday, he still does it every Friday night?
Every Friday, 7 to 9.
Blind Lawrence Radio.
Yeah, it's the LRWS, Lawrence Ross Waterhead Show.
Well, good for him, because he was always a good guy.
Yeah, he is a good guy. He's funny. He made us cards with Braille.
What were our names in Braille?
All our names in Braille at the Razzfest. He wrote our name above it, but there was a Braille card. And he brought all the show hosts.
It was just very thoughtful.
He was a good. He was a good guy. Did you ever see the video we did with him? I'm a blind motherfucker.
I don't think I did. Is it on YouTube?
Oh, I'm sure it's somewhere. I mean, yeah, it was pretty funny. He was. I wrote a whole rap about him. With him, he did the whole rap. He rapped this whole song, and then we shot a video with him. Oh my God, it was so fucking funny.
He was great content to the show. I hated seeing him leave. It's like, yeah, you know, 25. I love talking with 25. Him and I, you know, I called the show the other day when Burke was on. And Bubba, for some reason, didn't know who I was. And I was like, Bubba.
He was like, I don't know you.
He's like, who are you? I'm like, Bubba, really? I mean, like, I've only met Bubba personally a couple times, but wow. I know that.
I mean, how many times have we talked about Raz Radio, and you've sent clips of Raz Radio in that we've played on the air?
you replay my show for a year and a half on the network. My entire show played on Saturdays on the network.
Who are you?
Who are you again? So I was kind of like, man, really? I mean, because what the fuck? Anyway, anything else you want to really push on, Mike? And again, any help I can be, I'm there for you.
No, I appreciate it. Good talking with you, Sean. Like I said, check me out on Twitch. I'll give a quick plug here. I do it real fast. Tuesdays, Kush Cab, 10 to noon. Clusterfuck every day, 9 to 11. Trace and Joe, 11 to 1. Friday night, 8:30 p.m., The Bar Show. Saturday, 9:30 p.m., Net After Dark on twitch.tv/clusterfuck.
And random.
/ Cluster F Show.
Cluster F Show. There you go. Didn't we have that conversation already tonight, Mike?
I fucking blew it. Fucking blew it.
And you guys got random stuff you're doing also. You're popping in here and there.
I mean, we'll be doing more and more.
What's Trace blowing up bears for? What's going on with the bear blowing up?
I don't know. He's that's the deal. He's just his new thing. But I think maybe the dick punch will get him back into the rap game. That we can get out of the flamethrowers and the blown up fire hydrants and the Tannerite. It's giving Donna ulcers.
Yeah, that doesn't sound.
I could imagine how
great.
Many ulcers Trace has given her.
A lot.
All right. You know, Mike, I appreciate you taking the time to join us. Anytime I can help you with anything, please let me know. The last thing I want to leave you with, all right, the last question, I guess, as we're moving on here, is the other day I heard this. I don't remember where I heard it. I think it was the actual real song, and it made me think of it. But one of the songs you did within the last year was Clem and I. In the end, it's Clem and I. Any thoughts on that?
It's kind of weird because you can almost pinpoint after that, I did that song, and it wasn't much longer than it just, I don't know what happened.
Okay.
I don't know, but that was, it was ironic.
That was a transition right after that.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. Wow. All right, brother. Well, you have a great night. Go make that dick punch video.
All right, man. Hopefully. Thanks for having me on, Sean. Take care, man.
All right, Mike. I'll talk to you soon. Bye, have a great night.
Bye.
You too.
Peace. There goes Mike Wathers. I appreciate his time. I hope you guys enjoyed that. I know I enjoyed it. I've always been a big fan of his. I've always been a big fan of the Bubba Army and Bubba still. And I still will be a big fan of Bubba. It's like mommy and daddy broke up and we're going to have to all figure out how to do this right. And the Bubba Army has to stop cannibalizing each other.
I've never seen people talk on chat like I have tonight.
I haven't even been paying attention. Every once in a while, I look over.
I just don't even.
And I see something, and I'm
understand what's going on. But
that goes to what I was saying about Twitch and Facebook and.
Yikes. Yeah, that's a whole different ball of wax. Right,
how
there.
It's caused a different kind of environment for the whole situation. I appreciate all the new listeners. I know you're here. I know you're here because Mike's here. I'm sure some of you are here because Ledge will be here soon. And I appreciate you. And I love all of you. That's part of the way I am. I try to show understanding and appreciation to everybody without trying to hurt anybody. But, hey, that's the way it is. We're going to take a quick break, play some music here. You guys probably won't like my music. Please stick around. Ledge will be on at 8:30. I just need to go to the bathroom real fast, grab another beer, and take a breather for a sec. You guys are listening to First 52, RazRadioLive.com, Salty Talk Radio, Twitch.tv/SeanRaz. We'll be back in a couple minutes, my friends. Just sit tight. And I hit the play button, and it plays, usually. Whew. Sometimes. No, I'm not playing yet, honey, so don't say anything. I'll turn your mic off. Old equipment, old computers, things work slow, things freeze up. Ask Dave, he'll yell at me for it eventually. Four Toad.
Exclusive all-male bohemian club in California, where every year at this time, the elite from around the country get together for 2.5 weeks of fun and games.
Gemini.
As this special assignment reports.
A non-essential elite presidential retreat, confidential, discreet, monumental deceit. They're not gentle or sweet, more than mental defeat. Once you enter your seat, well, now you're in for a treat. The cremation of care to the creation of fear. This location is where they vacation each year. My frustration, I swear, is for the whole nation to hear. My donation to your ears, world domination is near. Listen, wealthy and well-placed are these snake-eyed hawks. Unhealthy and pale-faced at the lakeside talks. I've come to warn you, they cover their heads with hoods and dance around naked in California's redwoods. A gentleman's club equipped with good drinks and table shows. Hat legs rolled up, foot winks and cable toes. Mock sacrifices for Moloch, alcoholics, frolic. Political false prophets come to pickpocket your wallet. Who? Tell me who? Tell me who? 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 Tell me who? Tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me, tell me, tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me, tell me, tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me, tell me, tell me who? Membership grows by 15. Evidence to could bury presidents if seen. There'll be more than regrets if one of their secrets gets told. There will be more than threats as the last cigarette gets rolled. You must have plenty of money to enter the windowless tomb. 322, not many have been through this room. Trust me, the order of death amounts to more than masons. Trilateral commission council on foreign relations. Listen, I'll come to paint a portrait of a picture scary. It's like a eugenics project, the way they intermarry. Scriptures vary, but many say that it's just a mirage. Made the money off the slave trade and espionage. Ask the paparazzi, Father George's pops was a Nazi. Clear the smoke and you'll find old folks cloaked in Versace. Watch me expose those that chose a lousy copy of a German fraternity financed by the drowsy poppy. Who? Tell me who? Tell me who? 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 Tell me who? Tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me, tell me, tell me who? Who? Tell me who? Tell me, tell me, tell me who? Who?
tell me who, 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 tell me who.
Secret society.
The wood clackers. You're not cracking a nut's cage. Getting this pick's not gonna be easy. Get there, both ways. It's gonna be a major fucking harness to keep it down. And we're not gonna be able to do it without the proper equipment. One of those, dude. One of those. You know what we're gonna have to do, Cage? Infiltrate. Because that's how tight the security is. Because we've got what it takes. But it's gonna take all we've got. Okay. Two black skin tight jumpsuits, crossbow grappling hook with retracto action, blow darts with horse tranquilizer tips, night vision goggles, tear gas, one 15-inch Bowie knife with compass in the handle, bungee cord, one bag of Funyuns.
Those are mine.
And walkie-talkies.
Looks like you fellas are fixing to take the law in your own hands.
No. It's going camping.
All I'm saying is some people might think you're planning to overthrow the government. And some of us folks might give you a thumbs up.
Way up.
Right.
We're being boned, my friend. They're taxing the shit out of us and spending their ill-gotten booty on poison fluoridation machines and prophylactics, rubbers, cum catchers for the children. Ribbed for her pleasure. What in the hell does that even mean?
And they say I got no right to buy a bazooka?
No can do, Chief. Screw it, stuff it, whatever you gotta do. I'm gonna cut it off if I have to. You put that thing out here one more time. I'm speaking in metaphor, but I think you boys know what I'm talking about, right? Draw near. Quiet times now. I can ground resistance. It's real.
Could you just ring us up?
I'd love to ring you up, son.
Yeah. $1,682.
The nunchucks, I believe, were on sale.
No, that was last month.
Okay, how much for just the walkie-talkies?
$9,999.
How much do you have?
$20.
You only have $20.
Fuck!
Do we really need the walkie-talkies?
Of course we need the walkie-talkies. It's the only way to triangulate our mission objectives.
It looks like it's time to rock our way out of a tight situation.
Let's blow this freak's mind with a tailor-made jam.
Natch.
The government totally sucks, you motherfucker. The government totally sucks. Ben Franklin was a rebel indeed. He liked to get naked while he smoked on the weed. He was a genius, but if he was here today, the government would fuck him up as righteous aid. Now let me tell you something about the government. They're fucking up the environment.
Say what?
They're taking all the fucking beautiful animals.
Yeah?
And making them fucking extinct.
Oh, no.
The government totally sucks, you motherfucker. The government totally sucks.
Calling me a motherfucker?
The government totally sucks.
The government.
Because the land, love, and freedom is just a baby's breath away. And if we hold hands together, we can bring back the USA. The USA.
These ones on the house. Change the world. You change it, boys. Oh.
I fell for it. USA got me. And those prize. Everything's 10% off. 10% off. USA.
There's a different group to get pissed off at you in this country for everything you're not supposed to say. Can't say fruit, can't say faggot, can't say queer, can't say Nancy boy, can't say pansy. Can't say nigger, boogie, jig, jigaboo, skinhead, jungle bunny, mooly, moolignon, or schwatzer. Can't say yid, heeb, zeeb, kike, mocky, dago, guinea, wop, ginzo, greaser, greaseball, spick, beaner, oye, tiger, PR, mick, donkey, turkey, limey, frog, squarehead, kraut, jerry, hun, chink, jap, nip, slope, slopehead, zip, zipperhead, gook. There is absolutely nothing wrong. There is absolutely nothing wrong with any of those words in and of themselves. They're only words. It's the context that counts. It's the user. It's the intention behind the words that makes them good or bad. The words are completely neutral. The words are innocent. I get tired of people talking about bad words and bad language. Bullshit. It's the context that makes them good or bad. The context that makes them good or bad. For instance, you take the word nigger. There is absolutely nothing wrong with the word nigger in and of itself. It's the racist asshole who's using it that you ought to be concerned about. We don't care when Richard Pryor or Eddie Murphy say it. Why? Because we know they're not racists. They're niggers. Context. Context. We don't mind their context because we know they're black. Hey, I know I'm Whitey, the blue-eyed devil, patio fade, gray boy, honky motherfucker myself. Don't bother my ass. They're only
words. All right, guys. Welcome back to the First 52, RazRadioLive.com. Salty Talk Radio, Twitch.tv/SeanRaz. Oh, they're cleared up finally. I think it's that channel. It's just that one channel.
Maybe so.
It's possible. Anyway, guys, welcome back. Hope you enjoyed here in Manson. Yes, we will be taking phone calls. We can do that here. Believe it or not, my little Cracker Jack station can take phone calls. 941-421-0401. If you want to put your two cents in, if you got something to say, if you want to support or protest. I welcome all calls. I'm not the big bad radio jock that's going to scream at you. I might not even know what to say. You might get me. So give us a call if you want to. Scott Ledger will be joining us.
We can just hang up, though.
Yeah, we can just hang up, of course. Scott Ledger will be joining us at 8:30-ish. He'll be calling in. And we'll have him. We can hear what he's up to and what he's planning on doing. Because that's what everybody wants to do. They want to move forward. You know, one of the comments, I don't know if you guys were listening to the interview with Mike there, but one of the comments was that part of the problem with everything going on is us. It's the listener. It's all of you out there listening right now that are saying stupid shit in the chat. All right, you can have your opinion, and that's great. Have your opinion, please. That's what this is all about.
Oh boy, what are you doing?
You can have any opinion you want to have. And I'm perfectly fine with that. But damn, don't attack where attacks aren't needed. How come I had to guess this was going to happen? Hi, Bob. How are you?
He's so soft.
Who?
Why would he step out to the man?
Hi, Bob Tuscan. How are you doing tonight?
I mean, all kidding aside, sweetheart, I can relate to him. You know, it's not easy being in broadcasting and being a radical conspiracy theorist.
No, it's not easy. It really isn't. And if you want to make a dollar, which I think, you know, some people are struggling with that in this day and age, sometimes maybe you have to can your stuff a little bit. I've had to do it. I've canned my stuff a little bit because, you know what, I got to support my family. And, you know, how else do you do that, Bob? And those of you that don't know, this is Bob Tuscan. He's a very regular caller. We have a lot of new listeners tonight, Bob, so I got to explain this a little bit. Most of you, honestly, have probably heard him call into a radio show that you listen to. No doubt in my mind. Anybody listening right now has heard Bob Tuscan before.
He's everywhere.
Everywhere.
I was on 1360 in Colorado last week.
Oh, where are you? See, he calls everybody. He doesn't give a shit. You know what he does? I think he has a map of the country with every single radio station location, and he throws a dart.
You have a little checklist.
And it's got, like, the phone number, and when the dart hits the wall, that's the station he calls.
I've been doing it since I was 13 years old, Sean.
Really? That long?
Yeah.
Wow.
I made my first call into a radio show at 11. I called up, and ironically, my phone call was about the fact that pro wrestling is one big sham, that it's all staged.
Imagine that. I couldn't even picture.
Thank goodness for
that.
That
would be your
knew.
First call.
I swear to God, as if it was not foreshadowing for the rest of my life. But no, yeah, the topic on the talk radio show, I remember like it was yesterday. I was very nervous as an 11-year-old. And they were talking about whether or not pro wrestling was real or not. And I called up as an 11-year-old with a hot take that it's all one big sham.
Wrestling.
Go figure.
Yeah, imagine that. I couldn't have figured that. And
so
my balls hurt.
Good to hear old Mikey Wathers on the show. You know, as much as I want to fault him for his sentiment in selling out for the sake of getting a paid gig in broadcasting or in entertainment, I can somewhat relate. It's tough out there.
It is tough out there, and everybody's struggling and trying, and it's nice to see. Thank you, Donkey Teeth. We just got 200 bits from Donkey Teeth. See, honey, we are an affiliate, a partner with...
Oh, yeah, 200 bits.
200 bits. Wait, ready? Ready?
No.
Ready?
I'll murder you right now.
Do you want to see her smash
in
my head,
sleep,
my face
I will murder you tonight.
I have
Do
one.
Not touch that bell.
She'll cut my penis off as I sleep.
That's sick, but I will kill you.
Let's see, Bobbit. 200 bits. Ding, ding, ding.
Fuck, good thing Bob doesn't have a bell. You know, somebody on chat actually said that this is not Bubba Army. I'm talking about us. And Bob, hold on for a second, because you're not, and you'd say negative things.
Well,
so give me one second.
It's not.
He was referring to saying that I am not Bubba Army, which that insults me.
Why?
Because I have been Bubba Army. I've been very supportive of Bubba. I didn't say anything negative. Manson didn't say anything negative. We spoke truths. We discussed what's going on. We never attacked anyone. The only people I attacked, honestly, was the fucking listeners that are being douchebags in general. Yes, I did attack Twitch.
Oh,
all right, you got a problem
my.
With me fucking attacking Twitch? Sorry about your luck, buddy. But Twitch is part of what has destroyed the entire foundation of what Bubba Army is. So if you're calling yourself Bubba Army and you don't understand what Bubba Army is, so fuck off, all right? All right,
wow.
Bob, so what else did you want to talk about?
Jesus Christ.
300 bits, Bubba Army,
oh
no
God,
more
Bob.
Twitch, ding, ding, ding.
God damn. Fucking, it just pisses me off, because that's part of the problem. That's part of what has happened to this whole beautiful thing that we had had, is the listeners, the fucking
it.
Haters that want to go off. I'm not a hater. I'm not talking bad about anybody. I still listen to Bubba every day. I still will subscribe to Bubba. He will still get my money. You know what? I don't even use RadioIO.com, but I subscribe every month because that's my way of supporting Bubba. I don't cheer bits every day. Sorry. I don't need the attention every day. Yeah, I want some attention every once in a while. And yeah, I do reach out for it every once in a while. But that's not what I'm about.
Okay, relax. It was one dude. Calm down.
No.
Lexi, don't tell him to relax. This is great radio. Sean, you're not Bubba Army, dude. You are a bad Bubba Army, dude, Sean Rabbit.
Bad Bubba Army. Bad Bubba Army.
That's
bad
hilarious.
Bubba Army.
Like, ooh, you're not part of the Bubba Army. oh, no.
Hey, Lexi, you want to come over and build a pillow fort and be Bubba Army?
Oh my God. You want to have a pillow fight, Bob? Really?
No, let's make a fort and be all Bubba Army.
Oh, wow. No, thanks.
You know what we used to do? We didn't even do
no
pillow
thanks to
forts.
All this. You have a call coming in, I think.
Oh, yeah, I do. Hold on. Get up here.
He doesn't pay attention to that, you guys.
That's why
so
I gave you a screen
to
be able
call.
To see it. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
We got a call from the 9. I got a bunch of. Hello, who's there?
It's Mike, first time caller. I am a trucker. You may know me.
What's up, trucker Mike?
Doing not much. How you been, brother?
I'm doing good, man. I'm doing real good. Bob, you remember trucker Mike, don't you?
We've met.
Full trucker effect, weeks. Trucker Mike.
We had some wings
How's
together.
Going, Bob?
Oh, yeah. Now I truly remember, Mike.
Remember we were comparing guns at the table in the restaurant after
Sean
we were drinking
like,
beers?
You yeah. missed out, and I was like, no.
Yeah.
No, that was all you.
Just so you guys know, we got about 9 minutes or so before Ledger calls, and I'm going to have to drop everybody when Ledger calls.
Excuse me.
Damn.
Well, we got some stuff to talk about, not to be rude. Well, Bob, you were on the show all week, all day
that
last week.
It's cold.
Trucker Mike.
I want more airtime. Forget Ledge.
Trucker Mike, I just want to make sure you're not the only other one. Is there anybody else on the line? Okay, there's nobody else on the line. So what's up, Trucker Mike? How you doing?
Just committing a felony, going across Illinois, armed.
There you go. That's a good thing to do.
Oh, yeah.
So what'd you think I haven't heard from you a while, so I'm just kind of assuming you called because of Manson's Mike's interview, saying.
Actually, when it mattered who was on tonight, I had seen you advertise that you're going to be on live tonight, and I decided to listen. Having, you know, Mr. Wathers on and having Ledge on tonight, you know, it's just a bonus. Yeah, it's been a while since I've listened to any talk. Matter of fact, you're the only talk radio I've listened to since I got fed up a few years ago and said, fuck radio.
Yeah, that's what you'd say. That's what you were saying when we met up a few months ago. So, yeah, I feel you. I feel you. It's hard. I do it sometimes too. I just put music on sometimes. You know, the people I care about and love aren't necessarily there doing what I thought.
I've still kept up with y'all through social media and shit. I just quit listening to talk radio. It's just, you know, things got so shitty a few years ago, and I thought I didn't need it. Matter of fact, I quit social media for a long time, if you remember.
Yeah, I know. You just really got back into it recently.
Yep.
I tuned in for Roger Waters.
You what?
I tuned in for Roger Waters.
Roger Waters. Roger Waters. Anyway, reminder, Ledger's coming up soon. Just want everybody to know. Stick around. You'll be there.
I think you just said that like 60 seconds
ago. I did. I just wanted to make sure I read it.
In case you forgot.
Just, you know, short-term, you know, memory problems here.
Squirrel. I have a question about Ledge before he comes on.
Go ahead.
What's his problem? Is he just like, does he just have like a personality defect like all of us?
Well, we all, yeah.
Is he
depressed? What's wrong with him?
Actually, he's probably in the best spot he's been in years right now. Honestly, 100%. I agree. I believe that.
Every time I hear him, I feel like he's got some sort of manic depression that he's putting out on the internet. Or, you know, he goes from one radio show, he's doing great radio, and next thing you know, it's like a freaking train wreck.
Well, maybe we should ask him that tonight.
He was a train wreck. For a while there, he had some problems. You know, not only between
he's kind
of
talked about
in
that.
His life that he's
yeah.
really close to, and it really sent him for a whirl.
Mm-hmm. I'll ask him. I will specifically ask him that, Bob, and I know he'll get into it because that is part of what's been going on with him and part of his recovery and reclamation of his life. Reclamation, is that the right word?
No.
No, okay.
But Bob,
I didn't think it was.
Acclamation.
Something. He did something with his life.
No. But Bob, anyways, last week, and we won't get to it tonight, but I would like for you to call in maybe next week or the following, because after you called in last week, I started getting some messages about people that are really pissed at you for stuff that I didn't even know about. They were like, fuck that guy, and that guy's an asshole, and this, that, and the other, and I was like, what? Bob's like Bob's such a nice guy. What are you saying? You know, and it all went on to do with...
You talking about Buzzy's dumbass?
No. But he probably said some stuff too. Well, he wasn't... I think he was out of...
He's mad at me for not being a supporter of the troops.
Well, anyway...
he's not the only one. I can guarantee that.
Yeah, I was being told that there were certain things that were being said, and I was just curious about getting your take on that, or if maybe I'm getting that out of context.
I mean,
or
you have 5 minutes before Ledge comes on.
Okay. Do you want to maybe go into detail on that? Because honestly, that day we took my son to go see Far From Home, and I wasn't paying attention really to anything. So I don't even know really what you said. It was just like, I can't believe you had that. You guys were cool with him and like talked to him for almost 2 hours and this, that, and the other. And I was just like, what on earth? You know, I'd never heard anyone have a negative response to you.
I don't support the troops. I support not killing people in fruitless wars for wealthy bankers and eugenicists. I think that we ought to have people get out of the army and not be order followers, putting their lives and others' lives in harm's way for geopolitical propaganda and bullshit. I know it's such a hot take that I don't support the troops. I don't support violence. I don't support brainwash, and I don't support fruitless wars for bankers.
Okay.
You can't argue with that too much. I mean, let's be honest.
I'm not.
And you know, Bob.
I think a different way because I was a Marine. I support the troops. I just don't support how they're fucking used.
Okay.
And that's another way to look at it. There's two ways, Bob. There's two ways to look at it.
There's a very narrow scope. I mean, maybe you can argue that domestic defense is probably the only utility that we have. I support my own personal troops. I support the militia. I support protecting my family with the right to bear arms. I support not having intruders come here and messing with my family, stealing and raping and killing people in my property. I support that.
Lately, if you see my latest Facebook post, I've been supporting gun-free zones because I believe criminals need a safe place to work.
Well, that's like, you know, we could get into the whole conversation about the Garlic Festival shooting. I guess there's been three shootings over the past couple of days that were pretty high profile. I only know the Garlic Festival.
It was 666 days from the last mass shooting, Sean.
Well, and that's fine. I'm not.
No, it wasn't. It was the same fucking day. There's two shootings the same day.
Yeah, there was one a bunch of shootings this past weekend.
And another one in San Francisco.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is you look at their gun laws, and it just shows how their gun laws are working for them.
And that's the way it all. But not even that. If you look at what happened at the Garlic Festival, right? They, in order to be a participant of the Garlic Festival,
Buzzy's
to go into
calling.
It. To go into the Garlic Fest, everybody, you're pushing it too much here. In order to get into the Garlic Festival, you had to get wanded, you had to get pat down, and you couldn't have any kind of weapon when you went into the Garlic Festival. But this guy sneaks in the backyard. Buzzy, what's up? Buzzy?
Did he give up?
Did I hang up on everybody?
I don't know.
No, I'm still here.
No.
He's there.
Buzzy, are you there?
Fuck the troops, Buzzy. Fuck the troops.
Oh, don't.
Money, old buzzer.
Oh.
Yeah, Buzzy's not there.
30 seconds till ledge.
Yeah. 30 seconds. 30 seconds till ledge. The countdown is on. All right, guys. I'm
saved by the ledge.
Saved by the ledge. It's at the end of the ledge. All right, guys. I will talk to you both soon. Be cool. Everybody hung up at once, or something happened there. I didn't even hang up on anybody.
I don't think I really get the whole F the troops thing. I really do need a more throw. I get partially where he's coming from, but I don't understand what good saying fuck the troops does.
Well, it's not really saying fuck the.
That's what he just said.
It's making
babe.
A statement. I know it is. What's up, Buzzy? Buzz or Bob?
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Yeah, can you hear? Fuck you, Bob Duskin. Tell the whole fucking truth. Tell the truth. You said...
He's wound up.
Let me talk. Let me talk, Tuscan. You said you're glad even our fallen soldiers are dead. These deserve to die. All the way back to the beginning of the history of this nation, the way I took it. Everybody, fuck you. You piece of shit. Now, I don't agree with us being in all these countries either. But our soldiers have to do what they're told. It's their job. Yes, they're pawns to the government. I agree. But they're also protecting your life, you piece of shit. Fuck you. I'm done. Goodbye.
Love you, Buzzy. What's up, Ledger? How you doing?
Sorry,
well,
I brought it up.
That's not a way to answer a fucking phone.
How you doing, Scott?
Seriously.
Welcome. Welcome, Ledge.
Are you sitting on that air conditioner now? Because I know we talked earlier.
Loud?
Yeah, it's way loud now.
So loud.
Okay. All right. I can go inside, but I don't fucking feel like
it. It wasn't that loud before, but when that time it was like, holy shit, are you sitting on top of it?
Let's see what we got here. Hang on. If it's too loud, I'll go inside. All right. Is it still loud?
No, that's acceptable. We can deal with that. That's cool. We're good.
All right. Yeah, I can go inside. You know what? Fuck it. I'll go inside.
No, I want you to be able to curse.
It's gorgeous. It's gorgeous. It's
no.
Just hang on a second here.
Yeah, no, chill out, dude. Chill out outside. It's cool.
Before we get this interview officially underway, can I say something?
Sure.
Don't ever be a spy because you hold information like a leaky fucking paper bag.
I'm telling you, man.
Okay. I tune in and I heard a market, a format, and names mentioned. Holy shit.
I didn't. Oh, did I?
Yes.
Oh. I leak bad. Yeah, I'm sorry.
What do you think, Mike? It was great to hear Mike, by the way. What do you think Mike and your wife are giving you so much shit, dude?
I don't know. I don't pay attention.
Oh,
I didn't say a number or anything.
So, for future reference, Scott.
All right.
I love you, Scott.
By the way, I know who Bob Tuscan is. He's OG. He's one of the old school truthers. And all, but he's not Sigmund Freud, so I don't fucking care what he thinks of me or whatever his big problem is with me. I love you, Bob, but seriously, dude.
You had a problem with
you? Just listen to the interview and then you get your answer. There you go. That was easy.
Wow. Scott's on fire tonight, man. He's getting everything marked in right in the beginning.
Well, I talk for a living, dude.
I know.
At least I do now.
Again.
It's good to see you. I'm actually looking at you on your Twitch feed here while I'm talking to you on my phone on Skype. So it's great to see you guys. Really, it is.
It's good to see
you too, brother.
Hear ya.
And all of the above.
Yeah, it's good to be heard, honestly.
I'm going to let you here. Listen, here's how this is going to go. Cause I don't want to
show, dude.
I know that, but obviously, I've already spilled some beans, so I don't want to, or maybe said too much.
Yeah, when we said you were being cryptic, and you're like, yeah, I gotta be. You weren't being cryptic, dear. We were being facetious.
Seriously, yeah. I kind of like was like one of those open mouth moments. And I was like, all right, we'll cross that one off the list. Anyway, go ahead, John. What were you going to say?
Basically, I'm going to let you direct where you want to go at this point in time because I've already shoved my foot up my... No, I'm just kidding. So you're back around. How much do you want to share about what happened with you? Let's start there because...
There are certain... the depths of it, no, but I'll take you back in time. We'll start with where Io ended. How about that?
Okay.
Is that cool?
That works.
Okay. IO ends. We get the fundraiser. I get the portable, home studio thing. And then I ended up getting a gig at this cheesy talk, America's Talk Radio Network. Remember those guys?
Right. Yep.
It was just a bad idea. They went under. They had to fire us all. It was a startup. It was a couple of guys that used to pitch stuff for home shopping, and they figured they could pitch all their gimmicks and gadgets on the radio and build a network around it. And they needed a morning guy, so they had me come in, and it was conservative in nature. And having gone from doing DC on IO, completely uncensored, and being able to like talk about things in life that you wouldn't hear on terrestrial radio, all the way dialed back to that was kind of tough for me, especially mornings waking up. It paid absolute shit, but here's what it was enough to keep me in town. I stayed in town. So while that was happening, a buddy of mine had finally moved out of Richard's second bedroom so I could put my studio up. And then I launched the studio, and if you remember, I did the first dozen or so DCs with you guys, right? Wasn't it like that?
Well, yeah. Well, you were on the station there, I think 8 or 9 weeks you did here. I did a segment with you.
Yeah, it was a handful of shows that we did, yeah. And that was more or less to just kind of test it out, see how the studio sounded. And that's when I eventually teamed up with some former terrestrial buddies of mine over Radio Influence. And I did just a Wednesday night show. I was actually streaming live at first. And then we'd start seeing the numbers come back, and they were decent. They were, in the mid-thousands, there were like 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 downloads. But our listens / downloads. But like 85% of them were all downloads. They were all after the fact. So, I'm a terrestrial guy. I wanted to get that live feedback from what you guys are doing right now. You have a pissed off buzzy call in, because you're live on the radio and you get that direct feedback. Well, terrestrial jocks like me, that was our feed. That was like our lifeblood. Was we knew we were talking to you, but what did you have to say back to us? And that, of course, back in the day, it was only request lines and that kind of stuff. Eventually became internet prodigy, and we'd get emails and stuff from listeners. So there was always that live feed. But I was doing DC from this bedroom studio, and I wanted that feedback, but 85% of my listeners were just after the fact. So Jerry said, hey man, why don't you just record DC? So that's what I started to do. And we did it for about a year and a half. And again, I was always in the high thousands, never got over 10,000. It was like between 6,500 to 8,500 downloads. And I would just wing it. You know, I'd come in, I'd have some queued up stuff to play and some songs to play. And it was just to keep my chops. I wasn't booking guests. I wasn't trying to get any of you guys on a virtual studio setup, because I really just wanted to keep my chops. And I was working at this time, I was working part-time at Q105 for Beasley. And then at the same time, that's when Bubba was at 98.7.
Right.
And of course, me being a rock jock, I was doing part time there too. So I was doing filling in for Jesse or the midday guy or doing a weekend shift. So I had this part time job. Then I met this woman named Kelly. We started dating. We did really well living apart. And you know, she's a fantastic artist. She made a tremendous amount of money, sick amount of money. And she started buying me things and taking me places. And for the first time in my life, someone else was footing the bill. I had always taken care of, oh boy, you know, three wives and a couple of kids and, you know, paying the mortgages, getting on a hamster wheel. So it was kind of nice to just sit back and let someone else kind of row the boat for a while. We tried moving in and it didn't work. And it was frustrating because we really did care about each other, but we moved in together and it just didn't work. And like 4 months, and this is where shit starts to go bad. 4 months in, she's like, you have to go. And I'm like, you know, I agree. We agreed to it. In other words, we did agree that it was
time to do something different.
Yeah, we just did well seeing each other a couple of times a week. We lived apart. We literally could walk to each other's house. So if we got sick of each other, she'd go on the road and travel. I'd watch her dogs. So it was a convenient relationship, but we weren't meant to live under the same roof. And it didn't take us long to figure that out. So I moved back. So there goes the relationship. Okay. At the time, I'm working for Tetra Healthcare, doing some promotions and marketing for them.
I remember that. Yep.
Which was great. Okay. About 2 months after Kelly breaks up with me, or we break up, oops, there goes my Tetra gig. They can't afford me anymore. Okay. And about a month after that, I get a text from my brother Paul saying, Roy's not doing well. And this is my mentor. This is my father figure. This is the guy who was everything to me growing up. He's my big brother. He was 15 years older than me. My dad was religious and he was a kind man and he taught me kindness and not to judge people. But my brother got me drunk, took me fishing. He was my little league coach. We talked about girls. You know,
that's weird. Your brother is your little league coach. That's kind of weird. Weird, but I mean, it's the age difference of your family, because I do know you are the youngest in that whole group.
Yeah. My brothers and sisters, my brother Roy and my two sisters were 13, 14, and 15 years older than me. My father was a horny Catholic with a big dick. And, of course, they weren't allowed to wear protections, but he just kept making babies. And I was the last one to come along. So my dad took kind of a spiritual context to his life, which was really good, by the way. And, you know, it really instilled some deeper meaning in my life as a father figure teaching me that. But if every other category in life, hey, want to go out front, have a catch? Hey, you feel like going swimming? Yeah, me and my girlfriend are going to the lake. You want to come? You want to go fishing? We were fishing buddies, man. I grew up fishing with my brother. So in December, I get this message that his liver cancer, which he had under control, and he really did, had somehow, he skipped a couple of MRIs. He goes back. Next thing you know, he's just riddled with cancer, his bones, his spine. And the same thing that happened with my sister Susan, where I had 7 weeks of closure from notice to death, the exact same thing I was going to go through with Roy.
I remember that.
From the moment I heard from Paul to the moment we put him in the ground was 7 weeks. So I barely had any closure. So I lost my girlfriend, my job, and my mentor all at once, bro.
Wow. That can mess you up, man. That can really, really, really mess you up psychologically.
Yeah. So instead of, you know, doing my best to climb out of it with like a spiritual base or a foundation of anything, I chose to drink, dude. I'm going to say it. I did. And, you know, it started off as just a way to kill the pain, and then it became an everyday thing. And then, you know, I'm not even going to get into how bad it got, but let's just say it got bad and leave it at that.
Now you're not drinking at all now, right?
No. I'll be 6 months with no booze next week.
God, that's great. That's awesome.
I go to AA. I go to AA every week, dude. Oh, yeah, I love it. And I go for the cathartic release. I speak occasionally. But I only really listen to the people's stories, because it teaches you it's okay to fuck up your life, and it reminds you that you can get your life back. And that's why I go. I don't really go for the 12 steps. or anything like that, because that's where I try to use my spiritual foundation for my inner strength. You know, they say, you know, find a higher power and all that stuff. And and I'm all about what people want to do. But, you know, it got real bad. And you hit rock bottom. Something takes place. I'll talk about that in the future, I promise. And then the next thing you know, you're thinking clearly. You're getting your health back. And instead of sitting around and not giving a fuck, because I didn't give a fuck. Okay. I loved my daughter. I love my dog. I love my granddaughter. But I didn't care if anything bad happened to me. I didn't care if tomorrow ever came. And that's the combination of bad depression, dumping alcohol on it every day, which is like, hey, here's some gasoline, chuck it on your fire.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Totally ass backwards. So in about 3 months, this is this spring, I really started to want to get back into radio. I started looking up north, and I sent a bunch of packages up north, everywhere from like pretty much eastern Pennsylvania, all of upstate New York, all of every state in New England, all the classic rockers and talkers.
I remember you posting about, you know, trying to look up that way, and that's my old stomping grounds, you know, that whole area.
Well, it was cool to think about if I'm going to restart my life. You know, I have my family nearby. My daughter's there and everything. So it wasn't that I necessarily wanted to leave Florida. I loved it here. I've been here since the late 80s. But it was like, well, if I got to restart, you know, and I sent packages out. I got a little feedback. I heard back from Hartford. But it was nothing. It was nothing like, hey, dude, you know, you landed in our lap. We're really interested in you. You know, let's fly you up to this market, whatever it is. And so nothing was happening. And I was like, okay. And I said, okay. And at this time, to go backwards in time, I had met this really neat lady, actually stalked her on Facebook. It's kind of neat. It's a cool love story.
Stalker, Scott.
I was just not myself. I was drinking. And she knew that she liked me, but she wasn't going to get close. She saw my destructive behavior. And I was in the middle of my destructive behavior, so I wouldn't let her in. So it was just like this mutual standoff where I was attracted to her. She's a truther. She's a sweetheart. She leads with her empathy and love for the world. Her name is Vicky. Whew, hang on.
Nope. I'm holding.
Yeah, this is the good tears. You know, it's the good tears. And I reached out to her in April and I said, you know what? Would you give me another chance? Because I'm sober and I love life again and I've got my hunger back. And all I can say is we took off like a rocket ship, dude.
Good.
I opened my heart. She opened hers. And it has been amazing.
That's good.
Amazing.
Man. I'm glad to hear things are going well.
I never thought I'd be in love again. I never thought I'd say that.
I'm glad to hear things are going well and you're moving in that positive direction. Because, I mean, you know, we've known each other, God, Scott, what has it been, like 9 years now, 7 years, somewhere around there?
Yeah, 2011.
Yeah, so, you know, I really look at you as part of, between you and Mark Salty, you guys really helped me develop what I became here and what rose Raz Radio. And
yeah, I just encouraged you.
Absolutely. Well, you encouraged me. You gave me ideas. You gave me different ways of doing things. You don't understand that you did that, but you did. And that's why a lot of people are attached to you. And I've gotten upset with you, and I've never really expressed this to you over the years with the way things were handled and the way things went. Obviously, you've discussed now why those things happen. And it's like, I always come back to you and I always love you, but there's been times I've been like, damn, man, why? And I understand that things can get to you and can affect how you are. I've been right at that borderline myself here and there, honey, over the past 12 years, you and I have been together.
Well, yeah. I mean, we all have our coping mechanisms and things that we go through when we hit hard times, and you know, when you have people that you care about, your friends and your family, and they're going down that path, you do take, you know, you take it kind of hard, you know. But that's just,
well,
I was in the throes of depression somebody.
Right around the holidays, and lo and behold, one of my really closest and good friends, his name is Greg Thomas, Greg's backstory real quick. He was worked promotions at 98 Rock years ago. We got to be good and close. You know, he's like a big teddy bear. He loves rock music. He was covered with tats. And, you know, we had quite the philosophical conversations backstage at concerts, and we would bass fish together and stuff. And Greg hurt his back a few years back and started on, of course, Vicodin. Next thing you know, he's crushing oxys. Next thing you know, he's stealing shit and shooting up. He ends up in jail. I visited him in jail for about a year and a half. Not every week, but hopefully 2 to 3 weeks out of every month. And just to encourage him, because all his friends turned their back on him. Nobody would come to see him. And, you know, it was like he bottomed out and I was there for him. That you have to remember, I was still drinking while I was seeing him and visiting him. It wasn't horrible, but I was on my way to my tumble. Meanwhile, I'm helping this guy out. So he gets out, he goes through 6 months of rehab and he's clean. Now, how's this for timing? I call him in December going, I'm not doing well, man. I need to talk to people. I need to let shit out. I'm not doing well. I go visit him. He's clean and green. I say goodbye. I'm visiting some friends over the holidays, and I get a text from a buddy of mine that he's dead. He OD'd.
Mm. Yeah, you know, I'm seeing that so much, Scott. I don't know if you know this. My son... 3 years ago, my oldest son, he's 24 now, so he was, 22 at the time. He calls me, asks me for a bunch of money. This was 3 years ago, I want to say, give or take. And it turns out that he emptied out his and his girlfriend's bank account doing heroin because he had a sports injury in high school, and he got addicted to pills. And after being addicted to pills, he couldn't afford to buy the pills anymore, so he went to heroin.
That's right. Well, they also closed down a lot of the pill mills.
Yeah. Well, this is Jersey.
A lot of those people that were addicted to oxys and Vicks and stuff, that's why they went to heroin.
Right, exactly.
Because the big pharma spigot had been shut off. Well, that's exactly what Greg did. Same thing.
This was up in Jersey, and he went out, and he got into heroin. And after doing heroin for a little bit, he started robbing... stores. He went in and broke into stores. Got arrested for that finally. Now he's been good since then. He's almost off probation. I have a girl that used to work for me, was an ex-girlfriend's sister that worked for me when I worked as a restaurant manager. She died 2 weeks after having her baby from a heroin overdose. Two weeks after having your goddamn kid.
It's everywhere. I don't want to turn this into the heroin
it's true, it's, though.
Yes.
It's horrible. It's a fucking horrible thing.
Richard lost his daughter to an OD, accidental OD at 21 years old. You know, she was like my niece.
Richard? Like Richard from the show, Richard?
Yeah. Richard lost his daughter in 08 to an overdose.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, and trust me, that's I can name 3 or 4 other people that I personally know. I can name another one that it's kind of chasing him. He's moved twice to get away from the habit. And, you know, so it's everywhere. So let's just say that Greg was the final straw. A couple of weeks later, I went off the deep end for a while. And again, I didn't care. That's what depression is. Depression is, it's just, you know, I wasn't suicidal. I didn't want to kill myself. But if a bus hit me, I was like, okay, fine, cool. That's cool. It was just like, it's just a place where you don't care. You specifically don't care about your outcome.
Right.
You really don't. You just become so just apathetic about things. So I made it through that. And that's the best part, you know, and I'm going to admit, you know, I had a decent upbringing, had a great career. You know, I was born with the ability and I made it happened for me, and terrestrial radio, of course, went through all its shit, and it spat a bunch of us out, and that was a lot to do with how I eventually ended up working for Buccaneers Radio, and then the IO show, and all that. But I never started to get bad at what I did for a living. In fact, I'm still at the top of my game. So the depression was, you know, losing everything, but it was also like Mike was saying earlier, I was listening, and he said, you know, you got to be careful what you say on the radio because it can keep you from getting a job.
Right.
And I kind of want to segue to that's when I decided that at the very least, this was after Vicky and I really started to click, at the very least, I was going to relaunch DC, but I was going to do it right. full website, tons of links, communications, tons of sidekicks, just totally just take that DC family that existed and from 2011 to 2014, get it back together. No pressure on people. You know, we're only going to, I'll get to the goals.
No pressure, but God damn it, send me your bio. Like, no pressure, but give me your bio. Where's my bio? I need that bio. Give me the bio. Where's my bio? Well,
No bell.
Yeah, I'm trying to build a web page. So, you know,
sorry, I'm just fucking with you.
I give people 2 weeks, and you had 2 weeks. Okay, you had 2 weeks then.
I got it to you.
Okay. Procrastinator.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm horrible at that.
I had to edit it because it turned into "This Is My Life" with Sean Raz. Like,
way he's too so long. Hey,
it's my bio page, isn't it, Scott? It's my bio page.
Yeah. Well, you know, we had artwork to do in those things, and you know, there's still so much to do with that, and building the web page, and getting all the links, and you know, but we've got you know the newsletters now set up with MailChimp or Chimp Mail, whatever the fuck it's called, and I've partnered with my friends that I'm currently temporarily living with.
1776 guys, right?
The logistics of DC.
Is that the 1776 guys from back in the day?
Yeah. It's okay. Alex and Danielle.
All right, cool.
Yeah, and they help people run for office, so they have all the logistics. And you know, eventually, when we get around to having swag and stuff, we'll be able to buy it at more of a discount and all that kind of stuff later on. So I just figured, you know, I really wanted to partner with someone. I didn't want to. I said if I was going to relaunch DC, it was going to come back professionally. And of course, this is what we're going to get to. This is the gist of what I want to talk about with you. Is it needs a platform.
Okay.
Okay. Iowa was the platform, but Iowa was limited because we couldn't. You know, it was Bubba Army by subscription. Okay, I couldn't just throw it on, you know, iTunes or Stitcher or Spotify, and grow the audience. You know, like almost like a grassroots way, because content is king, and people would find it and recommend it. It was literally limited to the Bubba Army because, you know, other than maybe putting a link to Bubba Army Radio, I couldn't post any audio. I couldn't say, hey, come check out our show. Because it was literally, again, it couldn't grow. It couldn't grow. It was impossible. You could not grow the audience from where it was sitting. So it was either going to be the subscribers or, you know, Iowa was gonna go belly up. And that's what it did. It went belly up because as much as we had an amazing lineup of talk shows, and I think we did.
Oh, great. Incredible lineup.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, it was what uncensored radio should sound like. Absolutely, yeah.
It was perfect. So you couldn't get DC any better than
just making sure I got the platform. Go ahead, bro.
You couldn't get any better than Bubba in the morning, Burke in the afternoon, you in the evening, with the floating of, you know, different things between Burke and you. That was some incredible radio. I remember those days. That's really what brought me into the fold of everything.
It was just on all the time. And there was always something good on, you know.
It was incredible radio. It really was. I used to make Lexi. Yeah. I would make Lexi listen. We would, the TV would go off.
It was aggravating when you went on
8 o'clock. The TV would go off. Mikey would go to bed because he was very young really at that point little, in time. Yeah. And we would sit there and listen to your show. I would go into the bedroom and call in. She'd be sitting in the living room listening, you know, except for when the smoke alarm. You remember when the smoke alarm went off? Scott, do you remember that show? I called into you. You probably don't. I called in and I was smoking a bowl at the time.
Yeah.
And I had the smoke alarm off the ceiling and I had it sitting on my bookshelf and I blew my smoke right into the smoke alarm and it went off and you're like, what the fuck was that?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you got to remember now that, the original lineup was Bubba and then the repeat of Bubba and then Shando in afternoons and me in evenings. And I was doing 8 to 11.
And Tuttle or Kevin or the Diacos Manson and Clusterfuck in between. In between you and Burke.
And of course, you know, Shando joined Bubba's morning show. So they bumped his show to middays and moved me to afternoons. That's where it was a different show in itself because we couldn't have the same crew hanging out at night because everybody had jobs. So it was tougher to get, you know, you couldn't get, you know, Ferris and Sven and and at 12 o'clock know, someone afternoon. Else in the studio yeah. and all. So it became more guest centric, and that's when we made sure we had, you know, obviously Burmese and Brad and Jack Blood, and the new DC is going to be a lot like that, but it's going to just have a rotational crew based on part scheduling and part people having freedom to do something in a live virtual studio specter. I might, let's say, book you and another conspiracy theorist as a guest, as a co-host, what we would call the two chair and the three chair.
Right.
And then book a guest or something that's a little less, you know, I like balance. I like different opinions, not just all the same people sitting around, you know, sucking each other's dick going, you're right, man. You're right. You're so right.
Right.
You know, it's good to have, it's good to
well,
have.
Well, that's why you always had Sven in the, that's why you always had Sven in the studio and Ferris. I mean, Ferris would call me out on my bullshit all the time, even though we're best of friends, he would still call me out on my bullshit. Or whatever he felt was my bullshit. And same
he would
with
call
Sven.
Everyone on their bullshit.
Well, yeah, he would call everyone on their
and that's how
that motherfucker is not scared to call anybody out on bullshit.
No.
So, you know, you look at the way Shando built his show, and some of it was like fun game shows, and some of the stuff I did was serious. And then, you know, I didn't want to be serious all the time, so we invented Faceplant Friday. You know, we said, you know, on Friday, if we talk anything serious, you know, we're going to apologize for it. And
those were good times.
DC's success was really not just embracing the listeners, but to let them be part of the show, not just as a caller. If someone wanted to cut a promo and send it in, we try to play it. That kind of stuff.
Scott, I got a question for you. Who the invention of Faceplant Friday, was that from the Richard race, or was that from somebody getting really drunk? I forget what created.
I don't know, because I remember, you know, on Deceptively Fast Race.
Was it Spicoli?
In history.
Was it Spicoli's stupidity?
I think there was a face plant. There was. Obviously, Richard ended up scabbing up his hands and everything.
Right.
I don't know if Faceplant Friday got its name from that, but it was just a great name for a Friday show where everybody's getting home.
I forget where that came from. If anybody remembers out there in the chat world where that came from, I remember there was a specific event that happened that brought along Faceplant Friday. I just don't remember what the event was.
Yeah, well.
I'm trying to remember.
I don't know, but all I know is basically it allowed us to do different things.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted that. I wanted Dr. Ivanka in there. I wanted to have a sexologist in there. I wanted to talk about everything other than conspiracies as well. When you're doing an uncensored show, you're going to limit your own potential and your own audience size if you're just talking, you know.
Don't
get me wrong. We need to be talking about Jeffrey Epstein, but there's other things going on as well. And, you know, so DC is going to have its R-rated feel, because we don't worry about, you know, anybody being upset by fuck you or, you know, suck my dick or anything that's being said on the air, because that's just the way adults would sit around a table, you know, bullshitting anyway. So I'm going to make sure that niche, because there's tons of new media out there. There's tons of YouTube channels, and there's progressive channels, and there's libertarian people, and there's centrists, and there's, I mean, you know, you got the Tim Pools and those people on the right, and then you have other people. Then you have some bigger fish like Jimmy Dore. There's a lot of people, but it's all fucking politics, all of it. So if DC is going to really eventually, I'm talking, you know, online, if it's going to be what it can be totally, it's going to come in with, of course, my government's lying to me. That's the foundation of what we are. We are ledge heads. We think for ourselves. Right. If you're a ledge head, that simply means hashtag ledge head, think for yourself. And if you do that, then everything else stems from it. What you think about religion, or what you think about sex, or what you think about anything, you're going to come in with your own take on it, based on what not someone else told you, or what you were taught, or what you learned in grammar school, or what you were indoctrinated to at catechism, or whatever the fuck it is. Question life. That's part of the fun of it is you know, is doing that. So DC online is going to do that. Now we're going to rotate a lot of people. We'll work out the virtual studio and how everyone could see each other and hear each other and all that stuff. Once I get settled into the new terrestrial gig, that right now is leading the way. Meanwhile, we're going to build the infrastructure of DC online,
which is the big. Go ahead.
Yeah. And that is all being done, website and all that stuff. So as that gets built, I've reached out to everyone who wants to get involved. And then eventually we're going to, you know, probably meet somewhere in like Google Docs or something. And I'm going to eventually, you know, everyone, by the way, that's associated as a co-host, or I might call you guys co-conspirators or something on the website. You guys will all have email links to the email. We'll all have your social media stuff. So your bio will be your picture, your couple of paragraphs. And if you move the mouse over your picture, all your social media links come out in a cute little tab on the left. So we have so much to do with just building all the contacts. I got to get with Cynthia about the old guest list. I got to start basically, you know, I follow people on Twitter just to know they're out there, and then I'll approach them about being guests. So as we build all of that, it's going to hit the ground running with the official Dangerous Conversation. Right now I'm thinking probably mid-September, okay? But I will, real quick, and then you can ask me about the terrestrial shit, but real quick, right. I'm just going to say DC Online will have two shows a week to start.
And you want to get the four, is what I believe,
of a
right?
podcast, which is just essentially me one-on-one interviews. And that might be just hanging out with a crew offline and doing something, but it might just be, you know, me with Lee Camp or me with Lee Abby Martin or anything. You know, there's a ton of people to talk to. So I will package that as Dangerous Conversation Show 1 per that week and just release it as a podcast. I'll probably do between probably 2 hours. Most people listen to podcasts for about 1 to 2 hours.
Right.
And then the other show, which will be, I'm thinking Thursday nights, because that's when most people are really available, will be what we will consider the live show. And real quick, I'm hoping to have that eventually be on Ben Swan's isagoria.com, where we will not be censored. It will be crypto financed by our listeners, and the government can fuck off.
You know what's weird? You know what's funny about Thursdays, Scott? What's funny about Thursdays is Thursday is the one night you can't find any good radio anywhere. I mean, honestly, that is like a dead zone. For some reason, Thursday night is a dead zone for good talk radio.
Yeah. And remember, you know, you can listen live and participate, and, you know, and I will be on the pre-recorded show. I will have people record, like on your phone, you can record a message and then turn it into an MP3 and email it to me. So I don't know what I'm going to call them yet. You know, DC rants or fan rants or something, where you guys during that pre-packaged show. So like, let's say I'm doing an interview with Abby Martin, and then the other one I've already done with Lee Camp, but I'm going to want to do like 20 minutes in between those two. And that's when I'll go to you guys that are sending in rants or audio. Hey, Ledge, love the show. We want to suggest this guy, you know, and then, hey, if you want to fucking rant. So the prepackaged or the just a podcast show will include those kinds of things. The live show is the best because then we'll have the phone lines eventually. Then we'll have obviously a Twitch feed. We'll have all the different feeds where there's chat rooms and all that shit so people can interact with us, because that's what you want. When you're doing live radio, you want that live interaction.
Yeah, you have to have interaction.
Thursday's good. You know, Thursday's good, dude. It will leave us plenty of time to be able to have a good time, do a couple topics. Everybody will get to be lead dog at least a little bit on that show, talk about what they want to talk about. And I will let you know that the third show each week, which obviously won't be happening yet, will be when I start to sense chemistry between other co-hosts, I will let them actually host the third week version of DC. So how about that?
Oh, that's interesting. That's a nice spin on it.
Yep. There's going to be a lot of people that want to contribute. I will find the ones that fit, and I'll say, okay, you know, when the third DC, online comes on, it's not going to be me. I will have a say in how it sounded, and I might have a critique.
Editing power and stuff.
But yeah. I really want to pay that thing forward. I want to use my show as a platform so other people can either share. You already have your platform, so you would come in with your platform already to pimp and talk about. But, you know, you might be paired with someone else who's just a terrestrial jock who wants to get into podcasting. And so that third DC show, it doesn't mean I won't sit in on occasionally on those shows, you know, if I'm not busy, you know, but to grow DC as a family, you really have to turn it into a family. And sometimes the best way to do that is just to delegate responsibility and say, why don't you guys go have some fun?
Hey, Scott, I got somebody in the chat room here talking about the 840 double tote coming back. Is that going to be coming back or what?
Well, I would have to be on at night, wouldn't I?
Yeah, you would.
Okay. So if we're going to come on at night on the live stream, what if we don't start the show? What if we do 9 to midnight on Thursdays?
Ooh, there's an interesting one.
Yeah, what if we do, I don't know, 8 to 11? I don't know. But if we do, an 8 to 11, then you bet your ass I'd bring that back. That was one of the, you build your show with pillars that people always talk about things. I love this game show on this talk show, or I love when so-and-so does this, or, And the 840 double took was my way of making sure that people know that we were not only 420 friendly, we were activists.
We were two times that friendly.
Yeah. So, fuck it. What was it? Blind James took that mantle and ran with it and ended up with, over 100,000 Twitter followers?
Something like that. Yeah, rest in peace, John Blind James. Last year, I think.
Yeah, rest in peace. Yeah, I heard he passed away.
I think it was last year.
So that covers that. And I'm going to throw it back to you, and then we'll talk about the terrestrial thing that you've already pretty much told everybody about. But I won't tell people half as much as you just did. Okay?
It's like announcing someone else's pregnancy or some shit. These people are getting married over here.
I don't realize when I say things too much sometimes. Sometimes they just come out of my mouth. The words just come out of my mouth. Scott,
Well, don't work for the CIA, dude, because they won't have to waterboard you more than like 10 fucking seconds.
Oh, they wouldn't waterboard. They wouldn't even dump the water once. I mean, no, I'm good. I'm here.
The reason I tease is because, I'll put it this way, okay? The company I will work for, the owner of the company, after acquiring these radio stations, literally said in an open interview online that he is going to do a talk format. Okay?
Right.
So he's not exactly,
hiding what he's doing.
As far as what's it going to be called, what's our demo, who are we going to market it to,
right,
who's going to be on the air, what the lineup's going to be, they don't really want to officially announce that for about, we're looking at about a month. I think we launch about a month from now.
All right. So maybe I was off on some of the names I said then, because, Burke's teetering on something that's 3 weeks away. I guess that's a month almost. I don't want to, spill things out, because, I do know a little inside from people.
Okay, listen, I'll tell you this. Listen, here's how it goes. I talk to Shannon every other day, we bounce, what do you think about this? And Shannon is, he's heard from more than one party. Okay. Right.
He's a great talent too.
I check out Bubba's podcast occasionally. And yes, I did hear. And that was so brutal when he told me, he's like, hey, I cuddle. I'm up for a gay in Florida, but they don't like you.
I know.
Holy Jesus. I was like, man, what a bitch slap.
That's almost as bad as spanning his asshole. I mean, I don't know.
It was brutal. It was oh my God. If that's going to happen, do me a favor. But, that's Bubba. That's what he does. And that's what Tuttle is. Tuttle is, I used to call these guys on the air piss boys. Oh, piss boy. And those guys are the guys that used to take the abuse, physical abuse, mental abuse, verbal abuse. But they were, they were good in that third and fourth chair. That's what they were there for. So, as far as what's going to happen, I do know that, yes, I signed my agreement, my salary agreement and bonus agreement today.
Congratulations.
Thank you, man. Now you know a little bit of the path and you understand that I have to take responsibility, not for how things went bad in my life, but for how I handled it. I didn't handle bad very well. So this is not to get all touchy-feely again, but think about it. When you appreciate something is when you've lost it. And let me tell you, this is a great second go around for me. I am perfect for this gig. I will tell you more off the air. Is that you can feel free to tell the world 10 minutes after I tell you.
I think I already told the world, Scott. Sorry.
Yeah, but I am absolutely perfect for this. I will say that if you like DC, you're going to like this.
I think it's going to be great. I think it's some of what we're missing, and I don't understand. You know, like 102.5, I can't listen to anymore because, A, I don't like their morning guy. I never did like him before all the heat and everything. And the rest of them, they're good, but I have that thing in my head, so I won't listen to them.
Calta? You mean Calta?
Yeah, I didn't like him before everything happened, so it doesn't matter.
You know what? He's been a dick to a lot of people and add me to that list. He's been a dick to me, too. So, yeah, I'm not exactly a big fan of him either. So, yeah, keep going. Go ahead.
Yeah, you know, and the rest of them, you know, like, I like some of the other guys, but I just won't give that station the attention. But there is no – look what happened to Berg in Atlanta. Why are they shutting down the talk stations? Why are they – you know, like – It's nice to see that coming up. If that's what it is, if it's a full talk station, that's awesome to hear. And I'm glad to hear that that's coming again, especially locally.
Well, the best part of something about this is it's not a corporation. Okay, it's a small, and I call it mom and pop. Now, they are technically a corporation. They own, you know, more than a handful of radio stations, but they're not, you know, they're not iHeart, they're not Cox, they're not Entercom, they're not Beasley. These guys are old radio guys. The owner of the company is an old radio guy, and he hates corporate radio, and the guys I'll be working for hate corporate radio. And they literally said to me when I had my sit down, they said, you know, we expect to get complaints about your show, and if we're not, then you're not doing it right.
Good. So how that's about old that? School. That's so old that? School. Yeah, that's awesome to hear. Yes. That really is old school.
Yeah. So, you know, it's not going to pay a lot because it's it's a small company. But, you know, there's a chance to earn my stripes. And not only that, you know, dude, I got news for you. I got a big fucking chip on my shoulder to a lot of radio managers who know I've got the fucking chops, who know I can bring the content, and not just serious content. I know how to have a fucking good time.
Have fun.
I mean,
right?
I like titties and beer, but yeah. I just don't drink the beer anymore, you know? I'm going to be that guy. I'm going to feel like that undrafted football player who actually made the NFL. And I'm going to go in with that chip on my shoulder like, oh, I'm not good enough for your show? Good. Or your station? Good. I'm going to enjoy kicking your ass in the ratings over the next couple of years.
Awesome.
So I'm going to – trust me. I'm not just motivated for my personal comeback. I'm motivated about my professional comeback. Very fucking motivated.
Well, we look forward to seeing it. DC will be coming back. Dangerous Conversation. Scott Ledger. We'll know more as things move forward. When you give me the authorization to share your terrestrial deal, then we'll share your terrestrial deal. We'll get it all figured out. I'm happy to hear you're in a better place than where you've been, man. And that's the most important thing.
I don't dwell in my past, and I hope none of you do. As far as my past, sure, I fuck up. You guys haven't fucked up your life?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody fucks up their life. The only cool people in the world are the ones who are honest enough to admit it and pretend and admit you're not fucking perfect. If somebody comes up to me and goes, hey, I heard this, and I'm like, yeah, so now what?
Now I fixed it. I made better.
I'm perfect.
Now what do you got to tell me? Okay, right. You know, you want to bring up my failures? You want to troll my life? Well, Jesus Christ, your life must really suck if you need to troll me. Seriously.
So that's the one thing.
Go ahead.
That's the one thing I was trying to point out with earlier with Manson. You know, it's like I might have my different thoughts on what's going on in that world, but I'm not going to be the one screaming at you about what you're doing and how you're doing it wrong. I'm going to just let you do your thing and do my thing. That's the way we should do life. That's what life's about. That's how we should be handling.
Do you remember Earl Pitts?
Yeah.
Piss off?
Yeah.
You know, that's what Manson should do Mike should do with Ned. I don't know the logistics of owning names because I know everyone's not calling him Manson anymore. So I don't know if that's some type of copyrighted material.
No, I think it's honestly the only reason I'm doing it. Because I called him Manson a couple times. Like I tried to call him Mike because he has moved into his own thing now. It has nothing to do with nobody told me I couldn't call him Manson. I'm calling him Mike because that's his name and that's who he is, and that's why I tried to call him by his real name. and not by Manson.
Well, as long as he can still do Ned and call him Ned, then if he were smart, he would find himself a syndicator, and he would just do the daily, like a little five-minute Ned daily.
As far as I'm aware, he can, because he's doing
it. When you come at it from an anarchist, you can say anything about any party and piss anybody off. And he would work well at morning show. It's 9:37. Time to check in with Ned. You know, and he could have dozens of affiliates overnight just by sending his demo.
Right.
But the problem is now, as you both talked about, how far can he push the envelope? What stations will hire that bit or that character? So you know, I'm all for him doing his own thing, but if he doesn't try to at least market the Ned character. Is like a branch on his new tree. Doesn't have to be exactly everything he's doing, because what he's doing sounds like he's a busy motherfucker already. I mean, that's good.
Right.
And Mike's such a great guy. And he's right, dude. I used to see him, Christ, in the hallways at Feather Sound, because that's when I left 98 Rock to go down the hallway to work at Thunder. And I used to do middays at Thunder, and, you know, Bubba Show would just be getting off. And I go, hey, Manson, hey, Ledge, boom. And then later on, of course, I saw him in IO, you know, which was years later. Hey, Manson, hey, Ledge. And we never, ever did one radio show together. And I always gave him shit about it, dude. Just come in early, you know, stick around, you know, or come in early and do some DC with me. But, you know, he's one of the best talents in radio, period. He's forever sharp. He certainly knows what he's talking about. But terrestrial radio is not the same as the company that just hired me. It's very safe. It's very apolitical. People can hint at, you know, not liking the president or loving the president or trying to light up their phones with some Trump talk. But for the most part, you've got to be able to, you know, pick on religion. You got to be able to pick on these societal structures that have really, you know, what the whole country is based on, and start to say, and you know, basically just shine a light on them. That's all you do. You can call yourself a truther, a truth seeker, a red pill taker. You can reference it any way, but people have the fucking internet now. And if terrestrial radio is going to survive, it's going to push the envelope. Right now, they're all safe. They all want to stay in their lanes. They don't want to offend anybody. They don't want complaint letters. All these, trust me, as soon as I got the offer, I started listening to the market. I started listening to what my competition is going to be. And I hear talent, I hear chemistry, and I hear flow. But I do not hear them being anything other than safe. They are safe, and I refuse to be safe. And when I told the guys, when they hired me, they hired me because they listened to the 1 hour demo of DC on my SoundCloud page. Mm. They knew I did 98 Rock. They knew I did Buccaneers Radio. They could hear the flow on whatever the format was, but they liked DC's content. And I will tell you off the air, as soon as we finish here in a sec, how much they did. Okay.
Well, that's good.
So, I'm you know, mom and pops. If terrestrial radio is going to get if it's going to survive, it's going to survive with some of these big boys selling off some stations and some really energetic, lower budget, talented laden radio stations are going to come into markets and start kicking ass. And that's exactly what I'm going to do with it. Killer lineup and an amazing way of marketing a station. And trust me, you guys are going to love it. You're going to fucking love it.
We're looking forward to hearing out more about where it's coming from, what it's going to be, between the terrestrial, between the online presence, and everything else you're going to be doing. I think it's going to be exciting, Scott. I think it's going to be a great move forward for you. You sound so much better than you have in the past, and I'm really happy for you, and that's really what matters, is that you've beat the demons that you needed to beat, and I think that's important.
Yeah. And one last plug for the beautiful cannabis plant, which is now the only thing I put on my body when it comes to altering my mind.
Yippee-o.
On a daily basis. No more booze for me. Physically, I feel amazing now. Not just mentally. You're going to remember, you don't put that shit in your body anymore, then your body really starts to feel better, and you're not slowly killing yourself with alcohol. And I wasn't, trust me, in those AA meetings, I was a rookie drinker compared to
some
people.
Some of those stories, man. Yeah. I did AA. Yeah. I was forced to do it when I got my DUI in 98. And you'd sit there and you'd listen and be like, why am I sitting here? Like, this dude's story is way worse than my dumbass.
Well, everybody's rock bottom is different, but what it has in common, you know, it's not like it was, you know, doing blow and going to prison. It was, my rock bottom had the same effect on my life as anybody else's rock bottom. It made me realize that I am the only person that's going to turn this ship around. And that's what you hear in those meetings, okay? You don't necessarily compare notes like, oh, Jesus, there's people in there drinking, you know, 1.25s a day, right, vodka straight. You know, I mean, just, you know, here I am pounding down some 8-ounce beers, but
feeling bad about myself
earlier in the day, and it happened to be every day, and next thing you know, it was every month, and then, you know, and the next thing you know, you're just, you know, bad. So, yeah, dude, it feels great. Cannabis is all I need. I just don't miss booze. I really don't. I mean, I had plenty of it in social society for decades. You know, when you're up on stage bringing on a band in front of 20,000 people and you're holding a beer, you're cool. You know, well, right, this time I'm just going to be up there holding a big old vape pen.
Big old fatty. Yeah. All right, guys, make sure you check out Scott Ledger as we move forward. Obviously, check my pages. I will share all the information as he gets everything developed and put together. Scott, I look forward to seeing you again, buddy. We haven't seen each other in a while, and I look forward to seeing what you do.
Yeah, I'll be around.
All right, well, I got to pee really, really, really bad.
Well, good luck. I'm happy for you.
I've already bumped Mallard because I didn't cut off my station. So, Mallard, sorry, buddy. I didn't mean to, but we were going too hard, and I wasn't paying attention, yeah, to be honest with you.
Sorry, Mallard. All right, guys. All right, man, I'll get out of your hair, and I'll text you that one more piece of information.
All right, I'll chat with you later.
There. All right, appreciate your time, guys. Thanks for letting me rant.
Much love, brother. Peace.
Peace.
All right, love you guys. Bye.
Bye.
There goes Ledger. All right, guys, thanks for joining us so much. I really appreciate all the listeners tonight. I hope you enjoyed the content here. I hope that we can continue to provide something you want to listen to. Check it out. Sometimes we get a little weird. Sometimes we cover different things. Tonight's been an exciting night for me. I enjoyed myself, and I hope you enjoyed the show a little bit, too.
I don't know if DJ Lucky has listened before, but maybe you'll tune in again as well. He kept asking about Hubbard and Harp and all that, and if we knew about it.
Oh, yeah.
So he said he'd like to hear us touch on that, which those are things we do talk about. So definitely check out our show, and if you guys liked it, that's...
That's awesome. I appreciate it. I appreciate all the cheers tonight. We actually, you know, I can finally take cheers and subscriptions. So I don't block out anything on the subscriptions. You guys can come back and listen to and watch old shows, whether you're a subscriber or not. But hey, help me out. Throw me a bone. All right, guys. We'll talk to you soon. Have a great night. Peace out. Be safe. You know what? I think it is, honey. Let me try this. That sounds better. It's that one channel. I got to fix the settings on that. All right, guys. Love you. Be safe. That's what it is.
Let's investigate the consequence of a bittersweet loss of sense, a weapon in a war against ourselves. The setting sun is loading guns. Don't be afraid of mistakes, emotions misplaced, to love or to hate. I don't know what to do. We're all lost and confused, just trying to get through in this world. Always trying to prove that we're worth what it takes, but it takes a long time. The dirt to see grace. When I'm trying to be real, they tend to be fake. When I'm risking it all with no time to waste, fuck this rat race. I'm leaving this place. It's time to blast off destination space. With the sunset hung behind us, universe to blind us from the moon, we'll watch the whole world explode. Moving free, unguided, through the beautiful, the silent, with the light show from a passing UFO, lost in the glow.
don't go. And I don't know how I got here or how I'm getting home, but right from day one I've been in this alone, with odds stacked against, I've been drowning in stress. They said, can you take more? I said, give me what's left. An old man once told me, Allie, don't ever look back. The sun.